ये करना जरूरी है।
जाके टाइमिंग कब है ना, जाना पड़ेगा।
अच्छा सर को भी जाना पड़ेगा, खुद ही जाना पड़ेगा ना। ठीक
चलो
है।
गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल, स्पेशली इन प्रैक्टिसिंग सीएस एंड दिस विल बी द बिजी सीजन फॉर देम, स्टिल यू आर टेकिंग टाइम टू अटेंड द ट्रेनिंग्स एंड बिकॉज मार्च इज कमिंग नियर एंड वी आर मिनिमम 16 ट्रेनिंग बिफोर वी फॉर्मली बिगिन एंड डीप डाइव Why caveat solution disclaimer? Is my voice audible or?
It's breaking, sir. I guess it's breaking in between.
Just try. Let me try to switch. Does this sounds better?
Better.
So I'll just take from my mobile because my internet laptop is probably having some issues. So now before we formally understand what is caveat limitation disclaimers, if the participants can just put on chat, what is their current experience in valuation? Let's say you have started practicing an issue, started issuing reports. So let's say somebody would be in land and building, somebody would be PM, somebody would be SFA. So how many reports they would have worked on valuations? So this will give me a fair idea to understand what is our level of expertise we have. So there would be someone who would be just starting, who would not have done valuation till yet, but somebody would have been expert in valuation from so many months and years. So if you can just put on chat, what are we doing in valuations? So that way I'll be able to understand much better. Or if anybody like to speak also, I'll be happy to hear them also. Not only in IBB evaluation, any other evaluations also. So maybe somebody would not be doing much in IBB evaluations, but maybe doing in banking and other evaluations. So we can just get a fair idea. I'm not getting any response. Does that mean that nobody has done anything? That cannot be possible. For sure, I know we all would have done. So Umaranchi, you have done from which category? In land and building, SFA or PM, which category you are? SFA, okay. So we have Umaji who has done who has some experience in IBC cases. And in IBC, the most important role of caveat limitation after September. So Naveen ji has experience in SFA evaluations. And Rakesh is in land and building, did IBB in 2019. So I'm sure we all, before IBBI has started this guidelines, we all would have been doing valuations and we all would be giving caveats. And the first common caveat, which I was also giving in all reports, that I am not responsible for anything. Everything is given by client, so hold responsible client. And I was also giving this. And why we were giving these kind of disclaimers? Especially in case of DCF and especially in case of projections, where it is very difficult to predict projections, we try to give a caveat to safeguard ourselves. But of late, regulators have taken a different stand. Of late, the regulators are expecting that though you are not supposed to make projections, you are not liable for projections, but by putting this caveat, you are moving away from your responsibility. So we don't want you to move away from your responsibility. Now they had said you should not give a negative disclaimer. It should be a positive disclaimer. So then they started this, they issued this guidelines in September 2020, which is mandatory for all IBBI registered valuers. So when I'm issuing reports, I mandatory need to take care of these guidelines which IBBA has given. So let me share the screen and we'll start understand. Mehak, allow me to share my screen. There are two Sumits. Allow CA Sumit Adda.
Okay, sir. So actually, co-host option is not coming. So I'll just do one thing. I'll make you the host only.
Yeah. And in the meantime, feel free to speak in between. Like if you have anything to comment, we would be happy to hear your views also. It should not be like a monologue where I'm only saying anything. I would be happy to hear my fellow professionals, because in our profession, we only learn by discussing and understanding each other's view. So we'll go with the caveat limitation and disclaimers, and we'll try to touch base on soft skills and valuations. My brief introduction already Mahek has given. So I mainly practice in valuations because income tax I cannot do, because 10 years I was working in tax-free country in Middle East. So when I came back to India, I was lucky enough that we got 3 new areas in for all practicing professionals, at least in accounting domain, Ind AS, insolvency and valuations. So I mainly focus on valuations and Ind AS. I'm also IP, but I don't take cases because I'm sure we all, those who are professionals would understand the benefit. The difference between IP and RV is you can handle 10 cases in an RV at one point of time. But when it comes to insolvency, once you have taken one case, you cannot do any other thing because it is too time consuming. It is too demanding. Whereas in RV can be a one man show, alone can run the entire show. But in IP, you need to have a big team. Without synchronization, you cannot work. So before we give, I think let's skip this one. I'll take this one in the last. This guidelines came in 2020 September and it made mandatory. And in the next review, which IBBA did, those who have not complied with these guidelines, they have questioned. So it would be good to have Uma sir's experience in the mid of the session, because since he used to work in Australia, now came back to India. So we'll have a different perspective. So before we go on this, let me also give you a caveat, limitation and disclaimer. So my caveat is I'm not responsible for my views expressed. At least AIF is responsible. I will be sharing whatever little I understand from these guidelines issued by IBBA. And my views are based on what guidelines IBBA issued and available on their website. Now, this is the gist I wanted to give what we used to do when we are giving a report. So if I say I'm not responsible for what I did, it does not sound logical. Even though the numbers are not in my control, future is not in my control, but I like to give this caveat. But then the regulator started having a different look on this. And what was the genesis of coming this caveats and challenge on this? Because till so long, no regulator was bothered on caveats. They always say, okay, auditor has given a caveat, we accepted it. What was the challenge coming here was? So it was normally those who do audits would have seen that in audit reports, we always write, debtors and inventories have been taken on the basis of management certificate, or debtors and creditors are subject to reconciliation. So if I write this as an auditor and giving a caveat that, okay, this is subject to reconciliation, does the regulator or does the third party get a fair view that the debtors' balances are proper? Probably no. And if I say I rely inventory on what management has given, does it absolve my responsibility as an auditor? Probably no. So though we all understand as on 31st March, an auditor cannot be there to value inventory. But by putting this disclaimer, you cannot. Similarly, if I write like creditors are taken as on certified by management, though everyone would like to safeguard themselves by putting these caveats, but in essence, we are losing the responsibility. And then it was happening in IBC cases. And I'm sure a lot of you who would have worked on IBC assignments will agree. It was realized in IBC that the left side of balance sheet has nothing right in it, and the right side of the balance sheet has nothing left in it. So we were doing valuations of IBC and we saw a balance of 70 crores debtors are not even worth 7 lakh rupees, because the companies have gone busted in last 10 years back. So the list of debtors which the client is showing in their balance sheets, last 10 years back, they were all different companies on MCA. So when we realized that what was happening, and that is a challenge, and that is a challenge which regulator was finding and which a lot of people are finding when they are doing valuations. So earlier, most of the times, if you see, the valuation of merchant bankers and valuations of valuers were accepted at all places. Of late, in 2019, the income tax department rejected a valuation of merchant banker. So this is a specific case of Agro Portfolio Limited. In this case, what was happening? The merchant banker gave a valuation of 46 rupees. The book value was coming 9 rupees approximately. So the problem was not with the value what was coming. The problem was the department read the disclaimer clause, which was written into the merchant banker report. And the department framed a view that when DCF method is concerned, it may be always possible for a company to decide the proposed value on which they want to issue shares first, and then they can do reverse engineering process and go back to the number which they want. And I'm sure those who are a good and expert in Excel will know why the Goldseek formula was developed. So this Goldseek will help you to determine the number you want to get. So this way, the problem was coming, which department had a apprehension. And they rejected the report, giving citation that when we read the report of a merchant banker, we saw that in his report, he has written that I am relying and assumed without independent verification, the truthfulness, accuracy, and completeness of the information and data provided by company. I have therefore relied upon specific information as received and declines any responsibility should the result presented be affected by lack of completeness or truthfulness of such information. Generally, all big firms, all big valuers used to give this kind of caveats upfront, bold, italics, so that they can safeguard themselves whenever any regulator questions them. Now, according to you, what is the major point which you think the regulator would have put a challenge in this? Which point the regulator would have actually a challenge in this, that this is wrong, this is something which a valuer should have actually done? Because most of the points, some places he's trying to say, okay, my responsibility is if the results are, the data given is not true, you cannot hold me responsible, which is fair enough. If I am giving you a false information and you have no test check mechanism, then it is acceptable. Anything else you can think of in this report where regulator actually questioned that at least this is expected from you to do it? And you would like to speak or write in chat what you think is grave concern in this disclaimer. So what did the regulator said? Regulator said, we are fine that you are saying that, okay, your responsibility should not be there if the management would have given any incorrect information. We are fine with that. But what is the most important was, you have not even done any independent verification. At least this is expected from a valuer that whatever data the client is giving, you should have done any verification. And in case you are not doing any verification, in that scenario, it is a challenge on you because you are supposed to do verification. So we all know that projection creation is always a management responsibility. A valuer is not at all responsible for making projections. But your responsibility is at least you should have reviewed the data, what client is giving, at least on a test check basis. And with, just by putting in a caveat like this, you cannot hold other responsible. And we all know the major fiction is written in Microsoft Excel, then Microsoft Word. And those who have played with projections, you know, how come the client starts writing stories of making future sales? And when you start asking questions, the sales started getting down. And we'll also discuss some examples where clients will do anything, whatever they want, to get the numbers. But when you question them, then they will come back to you and say, okay, Miss, now you help us how to get this desired number. So the department said that once we reviewed your data, we found that you have not done anything reflecting your expertise, except merely applying the formula for the data provided by SSE. It happened in one of the London arbitration, where the judge asked the valuer, what you did in valuation. So the valuer responded, sir, I took the data from client and applied the DCF methodology. So the judge said, so that means you are acting as a postmaster, postman, taking data from client and dumping into the system. Only the system is doing all the processing. You have not applied your brain while transferring the data from client to systems. You need to have at least an independent look on this. And if you don't have a look, then we will say that that will be a challenge. Then they say we are unable to brush aside the contention of what is the possibility of tailoring the data by reverse engineering. And they say at least an independent inquiry should have been done by the management, by the merchant banker, at least on a test basis. Even if you can't do full, even if you can't do the full basis, at least on a test basis, you should do this inquiry. Then they asked many questions on the report. Then they asked many questions on the report that why the beta was taken one when the company from the past few years was in losses. Why have you done any sector specific study for taking terminal growth rate? Normally in terminal growth rate, generally we all take data from 2 to 5% range. That's a general growth we all take between 2 to 5%. But in this case, they become very specific and they ask, so since this was an agriculture company, they ask, have you done a sector study of agriculture, that how this industry will grow? And if you have not done that study, have you taken a ballpark figure directly, 2 or 5%? So we need to be very careful when we are doing a working of DCF. Somewhere we need to have some substance saying that this number is getting arrived. Because in DCF, the most important number is your terminal growth rate. This actually derives the whole value. And whenever you do your working, generally in case of startup companies or high growth companies or in a mid-sized companies, your normal value of 5 years explicit cash flow will be generally between 15 to 25%. And the terminal value will generally come from 70 to 80%. It cannot be the range of other way around, that your 5 years expected cash flow is very high and terminal is very low. That can happen only in case of matured companies, which is very rare probability. So we need to be very careful on what we are doing in this. So then the question comes on KVH and department started working on it. And then they also read a lot of disclaimers which other valuers were putting. So IBB started to review all the reports. And they saw a lot of places people were writing that I'll not be responsible and we cannot guarantee that the report is free from error. So then the government got a little bit agitated that if I am issuing a report and I will say I cannot guarantee that this report is free, may not be free from error. So I cannot do an audit and say this audit may have an error in it. So otherwise the faith of user will get shaken. So the department started working on all the reports and say, let us put some caveats so that people will not give caveats like this, which will lose the essence of the report. Because if you lose the essence of the report, it will be a huge challenge. Also, there is a committee of expert report was published when the new draft values bill was getting published. So this was in April 2020, when the government was working on the new draft values bill. In that bill, they decided that the valuer should not put any disclaimer which will has a potential to dilute his responsibility. Because if you put something to dilute the responsibility, it will not make the valuation suitable for the purpose which it was done. Second, which is a challenging one, they say that the report should be capable of being tested through legal evidences in judicial proceedings. Here, a lot of people have concerns and the concern is valid. because when I'm giving a report, it is my opinion. That opinion cannot be a sacrosanct number. You cannot go into the court of law and put this as evidence, because opinion can always change and different people will have different opinion. So if I am giving any opinion on any particular asset valuation, other valuer may have a different opinion. And then you cannot say either I am wrong or he is wrong, because it all depends on everybody's perspective and everybody's assumptions what you take. So based on this approach, though this has already came in and the new valuation bill, when it approves, they have more responsibility on reports which valuer is issuing. So, and I always say on a sincere note that whenever we sign any report, at least in Companies Act and in IBC, we need to be mentally prepared that if tomorrow any dispute happens between promoters, shareholders, the report may go to NCLT. So should that report stand the litmus test, it should be backed by my valuation standards. So if I'm using all my standards and writing my own report, it would be like a bulletproof report. You can at least safeguard yourselves. We'll also see in the end of the middle of the session, what is the IBBI peer review comparisons, where IBBI has a challenge, where they say that what is not done right by various people, what was the challenge on disclosures that we'll see, which will impact a lot of people. Now, what are caveats, limitations, and disclaimer in a short, in a brief, if you understand? Caveats are a warning which give you to the users. So if I'm issuing a report, I'm giving a warning that if you want to try this, you can try, but this is my specific warnings. So we put a caveat on that. Limitation is when my scope is restricted. So I'm not getting certain data, or I have my scope is getting limited. So let's say there are 10 outside locations and you're asking me to stay at hometown only, don't want me to visit the specific factories for review. You want me to do a desktop based valuation. So I need to write in report that this is a desktop valuation I'm doing. So this is a limitation which you are doing. And especially in case of COVID, a lot of people were supposed to do desktop valuations, especially in M&As where they were not able to move to different places. So there you give a disclaimer that because I am doing a desktop job valuation, this is my disclaimer. So that way you need to give in the reports. And the disclaimers are when you want to restrict your liability, because it may happen your report will be sued in the court of law and the liability can come back on you. Then you need to safeguard yourselves. To safeguard yourselves, you need to give a disclaimer that this is for this specific purpose, or it should not be used against for this particular relationship or transaction. That is the reason you will see in so many cases, we always write, this report is not for investment advisory purpose, so that a buyer cannot always claim back on you that based on your report, I did investment, because I'm clearly saying it is not for investment advisory purpose, because I have been appointed by issuer or seller. So my report is addressed towards him. Generally, these are need to be used when I need to see that the information and explanations are insufficient. It might result in the inability for me to do valuation under normal approaches. Specifically in case of IBC, it becomes very relevant. Or my report need to be modified according to the present circumstances. Because in case of IBC valuations, I do not get any information. So those of you who have done IBC valuations will appreciate that already the company is in mess. The IP who has recently taken over the charge, he is a new entrant to the company. He has no background data. He has no knowledge of past what was happening. And client never cooperates the IP. So the client does not cooperate the IP, he will not get the respective information. And it is still easy for SFA valuers in IBC, but for land and building and plant machinery valuers, it is more tough, because they need to do a valuation without having the data of bills, without having the data of invoices, without having data of quantity details. So it becomes a challenge for them. Now, if you don't know how old this machinery, the client is not giving you any data, you need to make a guesswork assumptions. So then you need to give limitations. And IBBI has given a detailed list of caveats, limitations, which a valuer should use and put into the report. Specifically for IBC cases, they've given very detailed enough disclaimers. Whenever I need to use disclaimers, we need to always see minimum few points to understand how it is going to impact me. The first important point I need to always take care is, I need to see what thing which needs to be protected. So if I want to say somebody should not sue me for any my investment purpose. If somebody is doing investment based on my reports, it will be always a class suit action. Or which areas I might be subject to liability. I can always clarify that this report is for specific use by the company. It has been observed that a lot of people take report from a valuer for one purpose and then use for multiple purposes. So they will take the report for a normal valuation, give it to bank also for some loan purpose, give it to the departments also for some various purposes. So you need to clearly specify what should restriction of use. And IBB has pointed out many a times, in so many reports, they did not find restriction of use clause. And we need to see what is the minimum caution I want the reader to look into it. That is very important. So the reader should, and it should not be put in, it should be clearly spelled out in report. So generally, all caveat limitation disclaimer should be put at one place. So reader can read them at one place and take a call. And you should not put any disclaimer which you can say that if I was negligent in my duty, nobody should be held responsible. Or if I was negligent in my duty, I will only pay up to the amount of my fees. That kind of disclosures you cannot put in the reports. So 1st September, IBB issued the guidelines and made mandatory. Now, whether the engagement was existing or pre-engagements, after 1st September, 1st October, all engagements have to be mandatory following the CLD guidelines. This Rule 8 of Valuation Rules 2017 specifies that every RV, when they are preparing a report, they need to put this caveat limitation disclaimers in the report so that it elucidates the limitations faced by valuer. Otherwise, it will be difficult for a reader to give him benefit of doubt. So if a valuer says, okay, I did not got any data without getting any proper verification or original bills, I am doing a valuation, so he will be at least have some safeguard. So there was a committee of experts formed by IBBI. 4 gentlemen were part of the committee and they prepared all of these guidelines. Mr. Rajan, Sunil, Jagesh were the key members and Mr. Harish Dhamija was doing a secretary of support. So they prepared a guidelines on all by reviewing almost more than 100 reports. What should be the standard guidelines for land and building, plant and machinery, and SFA valuers. Now, why it is mandatory for everyone to follow these guidelines? Because Rule 8 is mandatory for all of us. And if I do not follow Rule 8, there is a non-compliance and I can be various other repercussions can happen on me for non-compliance of valuation rules. And it is a duty of RVO to ensure that the valuers, their members are following these guidelines. And that is the reason every 6 months, all RVOs ask their RVs to submit your details of reports you did. So there is a anomaly or there is a different set of practices between various RVOs. Some RVO require all reports to be submitted to them, a list of all clients, what have you done in last 6 months. Some RVO request only 6 months. IBBI has not issued actual clarification what is expected, but sooner or later IBBI will come with all reports to be uploaded to the IBBI once the new regulator comes in, when the new bills comes in. So by sending the details of every 6 months, every half yearly details, all RVOs are supposed to select some random members. So they will select some random numbers, select some sample reports from them and review them whether these reports have been issued as per standard or not. So in this report, the first tick box they will do whether you have complied with the Rule 8 disclosure requirements or not. If you have not complied, then it becomes a non-compliance and they issue you notice accordingly. But if you have at least put in all the check boxes of rule 8C, then your report is halfway through. So those who have used earlier rule 8, now it got amended from October 2020. So you need to update your reports if you have not updated your reports, because mostly we go by copy-paste approach. So whatever report I would have made first, every my office follows that same report. But if the rules have changed, I need to update the report. So rule 8.3 mandatory says, I need to give background information of the asset which I'm doing value. Purpose of valuation is mandatory. And appointing authority who appointed you is mandatory. In case of IBC, it will be always by a registered insolvency professional. And in case of Companies Act, it can be either audit committee or board of directors, whichever is there. Purpose of valuation at times become tricky, because at times a client will generally come for issue of shares. So then you have a purpose that, okay, he wants to issue a shares and under which section you can put the section. At times you will get a client request and client says, I don't want to issue shares, but I just want to know my worth of the company. So I just want to do a valuation for my internal management decision-making purpose. So he might have some hidden agenda, he will not tell you, but he says, I want to do a valuation only for my purpose. So it will not be used for share issue. So I need to write in my purpose that this is not for share issue. It is only for the management decision making, and this cannot be used for any legal compliance purpose. That way I will be safeguarded.
Excuse me,
so
sir.
These are, please.
Yeah, I have a two questions. In fact, both are related. Can please. RV do valuation of 11 UA? If yes, then can he be, RV can be appointed by shareholders?
Okay. Now, if you are asking 11 UA, I am assuming you are asking for sale of shares.
Correct, sir.
Not for issue.
No.
So for the benefit of all the participants, 11 UA is for income tax, where if I either issue shares or I sell shares. So it can happen only two things in company. Either a company can issue new shares, so then you need to go rule 11 UA 2, or the shareholders of the company are selling the shares. In that case, you need to go rule 11 U 1 C. Now, what happens in case of issue, only CA can do for book value method and merchant banker for DCF method for issue of equity shares per issue. In case of sale of shares, a registered valuer can do the valuation. There is no bar on registered valuer that he cannot do. A registered valuer can do a valuation in case of sale of equity shares. So that is, it is permitted. And why it is permitted? Because section does not mandate on sale to take a report. So when the section does not say a report should be taken from a CA or a merchant banker for equity shares, then it has been taken a stand by a lot other valuers and a lot other senior professionals. So when the law is silent, that means it allows anyone to do. Even the management itself can do a valuation under 11 UA for sale of shares. For selling a shares, I don't need mandatory by law purpose any external report. A lot of clients still take for the safeguard purpose, because client will always, because the assessment will happen after 2 or 3 years.
Yes, sir.
So when the assessment will happen, the client would not be in a position to defend that valuation by to the assessing officer. So client will say, I have taken the help of a legal, another expert. That expert is into valuations. So they have given me this certificate. So you cannot hold me responsible. So whenever a litigation happens, the certificate will always hold good true. So say, for example, in equity share, there is always no challenge by giving a report by registered valuer, even in your any name. So whether you are a CA, CA, CMA, that is acceptable. But in issue, it is not allowed. Even because in issue, it is clearly saying it should be by an accountant in the rule 11 UA.
Yes.
Clear?
Yes, sir. But who would be the appointing authority?
Appointing authority, see, generally what happens, generally appointing authority comes from a company, generally. Because what they say is that if the shareholder is appointing you, it is fine. There is no challenge that if the shareholder appoints you, there is no challenge at all. But generally, the shareholder says, why should we pay money from our own pocket? We will ask the company to get a valuation. So that is the reason they ask company to appoint you. But in Companies Act, in Income Tax Act, whoever appoints is not a much difference. Because ultimately, the department will rely on the value what you are giving. They will cross-check.
So basically, shareholder can appoint that.
Yeah, shareholder can appoint. And a lot of shareholders do appoint, because specifically those who are NRI and other shareholders, they actually appoint independently to get a fair, get a value. Because in, because anyways, in 11UA, in terms of selling of shares, you have no choice. You have to follow only one method. You cannot use any valuation methodology. That is the reason, that is the reason department does not prescribe any particular consultant report. But because in case of issue, there is a DCA methodology where merchant banker can always play. Earlier, CEO was also allowed to do the merchant banker report, DCF report, but now they are not allowed.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So now all these things were already there. The new changes happened was the base of value was not there in previous section. So if you see the original 2017 rule and in 2018 when it got amended, this base of value was not there. In 2020, when they amended this guidelines and disclosures, they changed, they added base of value. So now I need to put base of value, which value I'm taking. Generally, we always take market, fair market value, that's a base. Then premise of value also needs to be mentioned, though it was not specifically mentioned, but every valuer was generally putting in the report what I need to mention in the report. So generally, they will always say I'm using for going concern or liquidation. In case of IBC, we put going concern and liquidation both, because I'm putting, I'm finding fair value also, and I'm finding liquidation value also. But in case of normal issue of shares, it has to be a going concern always. Those who are doing valuations of fresh issue of shares mandatory need to read the audit report of the client. It may happen that I am doing a valuation and in the audit report, the auditor had qualified the going concern. Then it becomes a challenge for you that how you are justifying going concern. So either you should have taken a clarification from management that whether the auditor remarks still holds good, because it may happen the audit happened 6 months back. Now you would have got sufficient funds and that is the reason you are asking for new fresh issue of equity. So that way it should be in your working paper that you have actually read the audit report and there was no going concern clause. Identity of RV and any other experts involved in valuation should be mentioned. That if this is specifically in case of IBC cases where the inventory is something which none of the three asset class can do a valuation. Specifically in case of gold companies where jewelry, diamonds are the inventory, which neither the SFA or PM and land and building valuers can certify. So at that time, the SFA valuer takes the help of expert, that is another registered valuer from customs or income tax or wealth tax act department registered valuer. And they write into the valuation report that this is a fair value of inventory based on the expert, independent expert, Mr. XYZ, and you mention that. So that you need to mention who is the identity, who are the intended users of valuation. This is very important. This restricts your scope, because if I do not give this, anyone can use this report and can do a class out. Luckily in India, people are not much action oriented, so they don't do much suits. But in US, UK, anyone can use a valuation report and do a class out action against the valuers. Disclosure of RV interest on conflict, if any. This they have pointed out number of times in IBBA inspection that if you have any interest or conflict, you need to mention it specifically. And this is mainly coming in, and people are mentioning, but they're mentioning in such a way that people are not able to read, or the reader is not able to find out whether this is actually a conflict or not. How generally it happens, for example, some company secretaries are doing some filing services of a company. So they are just doing a normal AOC 4 filing or very small assignments of a company. Now they also are registered valuers. Now the client approached them to do a valuation. Now in the last 3 years, they have a connection, but connection is only the only indirect interest is they are only giving very small minor services. So they are writing in the report that in last 3 years we have given advisory services or compliance services, but the remuneration is not significant to our overall firm, and in our opinion it does not impact our independence and influence. So that way, if you want to have a disclosure, it has to be a very clean disclosure. It should come upfront. It should not be somewhere written in a place where nobody can read it. Now, this is like over information. You put everything in a one paragraph, nobody can read that. So they're asking if there is a disclosure, you need to give it specifically. Date of appointment is mandatory to be written, that when did the management appointed you, the board appointed you. If it is a company, try to prefer to get in a board minutes, preferred if possible. That becomes a strong base for you. If they do not do, at least get a letter from a director or a CEO that the board has approved your appointment on this date. Valuation date will always come from client, that what is the date they want to get the asset value. And date of report will always be the day which you are issuing report. All CAs who are RVs need to follow UDIN mandatory, and all other RVOs have different mechanism of UDIN. So that you need to take care of, not UDIN, generating the reference number. Because in certain RVOs, certain other organizations, you have a number that I cannot issue a report number one in January and number two in February and number four in March, and then again number five in February. So I cannot do backdating in many places. So that is the reason the UDIN and other checks and balances have been put. Very soon, IBBA will put a system that all valuers across all RVOs need to upload their reports, number of dates and reports, to avoid such issue. And if you have done any inspections or investigations, whatever details you've done, you need to do that. Here, investigation is not that specific investigation. Globally, it is expected for a deep investigation. Here, it's a basic investigation on titles, on inquiry, that should be sufficient. So these three clauses, CDF, were newly added in the reports. Apart from this, we had other sections also which need to be mandatory mentioned along with this. So I need to mention what is the business interest. This was also not there earlier. So now mandatory, you need to mention the details of client, that who's their owners. So if it is a subsidiary, what is the layer of subsidiary, who are actually wholly owned companies, then what is their entire shareholdings. So that should be mentioned. And it is better to take from client a brief profile of the business of company, and better to copy paste. So that way this compliance would be done. What are the nature and source of information you have relied? So you need to always mention that, okay, what sources of information you are taking. So mandatory, some things should be mentioned like audited financials. If unaudited financials, then unaudited financials, a memorandum of associations, articles of associations. Then if you're using DCF, then whatever software you are using, like if you're using Mr. Professor Ashwath Damodaran material, or you're using money line, capital line, what money control data. So whatever data you are trying to use in some way, or risk-free rate from RBI, you need to just mention that. Answer my one question very honestly. How many of you, those who do valuations, look into the memorandum and articles of association? Be honest in answering. Anyone who answer yes, anyone who does that. And I'll tell you in the second half why I asked this question. And you will agree that if you have read so many reports, you would have find this in the information and sources relied, that we have seen MOA and AOA. But have you seen in many reports, people write like this, that we are relying on MOA and AOA? Vishal, if you have seen any reports where people write on this?
Okay. Yeah, we see that people write like this, but I am sure that people don't follow in practice to go through to MOA and AOA in general.
So because we always rely on client, because we always think that whatever he is giving and saying must be right. So why to question? Because it is a basic assumption we are relying on that. And I'll tell you what is the biggest problem happened of over relying on client, which I'll share you shortly. So we need to realize what are the nature and source of information we are relying. That will always safeguard us. What are the assumptions you are taking? And significant assumptions need to be mentioned specifically. So in case you are doing something which is out of the way, which is very significant, that will impact the reader, you need to put there. What are the, then after putting all this, we need to mention what are the procedures I have adopted in carrying out the valuation. That is most important, because if I do not tell what is the procedure adopted, that means the entire thing, whatever I have taken is of, does not make sense. What is the restriction on view, on the use of reports I need to put? This restriction is very important. This way you can always put that this report cannot be used for particular this purpose, or you know, this way will, it will hold you, it will hold your responsibility less. If you don't put it, it is open for restrict, open for usage. And IBBA has pointed out this twice in their peer review guidance, that people are not following it. And what are the major factors that were taken into account during valuations? That have you looked into COVID, let's say in case of COVID, or have you looked into the market reports? So in case of, let's say, DCF or any other methodology, which factors have you compared? Have you compared the industry norms? So that way you need to put. Conclusions, we all know that conclusion is mandatory to conclude any report. I cannot put report open hanging. You cannot just put the numbers and read, say the reader, now you make your assumption, interpretation, I have given you the facts. You cannot do that. I need to conclude the report by saying that after doing all things, what is my understanding? That way you will put it. And then you give caveat, limitation, disclaimers. So it is mandatory to give caveat, limitation, and disclaimer, whether you like it or not like it, because the valuation rules itself accept. And specifically in clause M, clause M is very important, because when you're doing clause M, you need to mention that what are all the approaches I have looked and why I have rejected. A lot of people were not writing the reasons of rejecting other approaches. So if suppose I want to do DCF, I'm free to use DCF, because if that is comfort which I am getting and client is giving. But somewhere I need to write why I am not using cost approach and why I am not using market approach. The reason can be as simple as that it's a startup, so I don't prefer cost approach is good. Or it is a unique, so I don't get any market comparable data. But somewhere I need to write mandatory. This is very important. Now, in terms of procedure involved, what this all this data is given in IBBI caveat limitation guidelines in 2020. So they have given all these things, that when you are writing procedures involved, what is minimum expectation from you? The minimum expectation is I need to review past financials and do analysis of projections. If you recall, when you would have done 50 hours training, in financial statement analysis, they would have asked you for vertical common size analysis or horizontal common size income statement analysis. Normally in Indian reports, you will not find these kind of analysis, but you open any US, UK report, in most of the reports, you will find this kind of analysis. So they do a common size vertical analysis of income statement that will give you a better idea that last 3 years or 3 years of client's data, how the revenue is moving, and next 5 years, how the P&L is moving. Substantially, if my sale is increasing very high, but my entire P&L should also move in the same line where my last 3 years projections or 3 years actual financials are moving. So that way it will always help. Now, the most part which a lot of people were missing, industry analysis and SWOT analysis, people were not writing in the reports. So they have asked that values that now you should also mention industry analysis. And there are various websites. If you go to, let's say, for example, ibef.org. So there is a website called ibef.org where you can find a lot of industry analysis. Any FDI movement happening, any government policies happening, this way you choose, they have given various sectors. So you open cement sector, you open textile, you open footwears, electronics, everything will find there in a detailed manner, which will be very good for you for copy paste. And these reports you can easily download, freely accessible, and it can come in Word and PDF. So you can easily put in your report. That will add value in your reports. And SWOT analysis you can take from management. Management can say what is the strength and weaknesses of their company. Because we need to understand, if I'm getting a premium valuation for a client need to justify what is the strength and weaknesses I have on my particular companies. Comparison with similar transaction, if possible, if you can have that data easily available. Normally these are paid data, so not easily available. And comparison with similar listed companies, if you are doing a listed company's valuation, then you need to follow the industry standards. Discussions with management, we always write. And mandatory, you need to have asked questions on projections by sending an email. By sending an email to management on the projections, this will be your working paper that an evidence that yes, you have discussed the projections with management. Management may reply or not reply on email, that is a separate story. But at least you have done your job by asking questions. Then you can always put your working papers that I asked these questions and management responded on telephonically like various questions. What are the documents you are reviewing? Specifically in case of those who are doing toll projects valuation. So if you ever do toll projects valuations or any lease agreement valuations, mandatory you need to review the documents, because their ultimate income lies from that document. Because normally when you do, if you ever get a chance to do toll valuation, you will get a document 1,000 pages. So normally nobody like to read that kind of pages, but at least read the revenue part from that module. That is very important to support your valuations, because the best part of these toll projects is you get a fixed number of years. So it will be 15 years cash flow, but the cash flow will be derived only from that agreement. So read that agreement. Whether you are doing site visit, then mandatory mention. SFA valuers have a luxury of ignoring the site visit. Even if they don't go to site visit, they can always write, I had done a desktop valuation. It is acceptable. But unfortunately, plant and machinery and land and building cannot do desktop valuation. In IBC, it is mandatory for them to do a physical inspection and visit the premise. Otherwise, it will be very difficult for them to justify how the value of particular asset is which they are quoting. And in case for any reasons you are not able to make it, you are making a desktop valuation, you need to then add photographs and report and prove why you are doing the desktop based valuations. And who's responsible? Suppose I want to do a land valuation, plant and machinery and a land valuation. Who will take me to the site? Who will tell me that, whose responsibility is to tell that site is this is the address? Should it be valuer should identify himself, or it should be client? Ideally, who should do it? For a land valuer, those are my land valuers. If the company has given you a data that this is a land, you will go on your own to find the land and do a valuation, or you will rely on company? What is the normally process you do follow if we are having land valuers among us? So in the Umaji, it is agreed that if it is unit is running, you should visit, but IBBA does not expect the responsibility on you. So visiting is always better because you get an upper end and factual information, but you have still have a luxury not to visit, even if you do not want, but LNB and plant machine do not have. Now, what is the expectation from identifying the site? It is preferred that the first client will identify what is the site, then the valuer should double check and cross check whether the client is identifying is the right site. It actually happened in Alwar. It was not related to land valuation, related to stock audit. So a CA firm was appointed in ICICI Bank to do a stock valuation, and the article CA sent the articles to do a valuation, and articles were very naive. Young articles, first year articles. So they called the client, and client took them from Alwar bus station and they took it to the premises and got the all stock counting done. 2 months later, there was fraud happened in that same client and the stock was zero. So when the report was checked, in the report it was written, all stock was there. So when the police asked the client, where is the stock? He said, there was no stock ever. Then they asked, what was the valuation you did from the CAs? They say, I took them to my friend's place. I showed them my friend's stock and they counted that stock. So he befooled them. Because articles relied that if owner is taking us, it should be the right premises. So yes, owner will take you first, but it should be your responsibility to double check. Because a lot of frauds happen in case of where the lands are two-sided or it is difficult. Now, what is also expected here is, instead of
giving this question,
please feel free to ask in between any time.
So what you are telling in the same case, I would like to ask, generally as a plantation machinery valuer, I am a plantation machinery valuer, in case of stock valuation, see, whatever data client has provided, that we need to rely upon. If I talk about specifically inventory in stocks, then it is very difficult for us to verify the ownership of those stocks. Who is the particular owner? Yes, we can verify the address at least, at which location particular stock is lying and at which location we have verified. That we can mention in our report also. But at the same time, who is the legal owner of those stocks? That is very difficult to verify. And in case of valuation, we generally take the ownership claim as valid and we mention in our report the same thing. That's all.
I fully agree with you and I understand your concern. No way you can verify the ownership of the stock, because it may happen. Client would have borrowed the stock from his neighbor shop nearby, put that stock in his premises, get your counting done from you, and you would have given a report. The support will be only, you will have some pictures of the stock if possible. So if possible, and when we do, we just try to take some pictures so that I can justify that, yes, when I was doing counting, we counted the stock and this was some pictures we have taken. I'm not asking you to take picture of each stock item, that we cannot do. Just an overall picture that, yes, we were there at the premises, we counted. And at the time when we were there, the stock was there. Later on, the client sabotaged the stock or the stock was rented, stock was managed from somewhere else. That is not my responsibility. But somewhere I need to say, okay, I looked at. So ultimately, anybody would like to see when I was there, was stock there, it was there. Can I prove ownership? I can never prove the ownership because it is assumed that the client is not defrauding. And if it is matching with the records, I just need to justify that count was proper. Later on, it happened many times that client put some other stock because we don't know what is actually stock. And it has actually happened in case of Videocon and Godrej audits. Client has put the empty boxes. You know, like if you see the fridges and washing machines, he will make a rack of 5 racks, five stacking. You normally, as a stock auditor, I normally will not go on the top and check every rack. So they have done some frauds in these kind of methods of valuations. As we did some valuation in Ahmedabad in a stock yarn company. Only the top layer was full of clothes, rest all was cotton. They say, no, this is like this, the world. You know, somebody who digs deep will find some or the other way. But IBBA will not hold you responsible for not proving ownership because it is a basic assumption that client has showed it is his papers, his invoices. So we assume the stock is with him. And that is the biggest challenge for plant and machinery valuers for inventory. And I'm sure most of you will still agree. There's a debate who should do inventory valuation, plant and machinery or SFA valuation. Mostly IPs prefer plant and machineries, mostly PM valuations to do inventory, but everywhere there's a different story. In Rajasthan, they prefer SFA to do inventory valuation because they say that now SFA is the auditor. He used to do inventory valuation in books also, but that's a different stand. IBB has not clarified who should do what, but this is what it continues.
Yes, sir. We are. I am fully agree with you. In case of inventory, same thing is happening. But generally, technically, if I say inventory valuation should be as per the nature of inventory. What kind of inventory is there in company? Say, for example, if cement is there, concrete is there, tiles are there, then it should fall under land and building value. If some engineering components are there, some bars, mortars, something kind of there, then it should fall under plant and machinery value. So mainly, majorly depends on nature of inventory, if I'm not wrong.
Absolutely, absolutely right. This is the ultimate benchmark should be. So instead of just putting this SFA class should be doing valuation, this class should do valuation of inventory, may not be the right approach. Always the what is the nature of inventory and which asset class is the most closest, that should do valuation of inventory. Rest, it can be a taken call by IP, what he prefers. On a personal note, I always avoid taking inventory on a personal note, not for the reason that it is risky or it involves work, only for the reason then because of this inventory, I need to physically visit a premises. Otherwise, my entire valuation of SFA, if you take my entire valuation of SFA, I can do by sitting in my office. Say, for example, my bank balances, he will submit a bank statement on email, debtors list, my advances list, my other loans and advances. So that data can always flow on email, but inventory valuation cannot flow on email. I need to physically visit that. So we have taken 2-3 assignments where inventory was there, but then it becomes a challenge of moving from Jaipur to other cities, and not because of cost, because of timing issues. And the problem is, as you would have also experienced, as a CA, what is my expectation of valuation? Client will give me a list that this is the quantity I have. You match with the quantity. That you will never find in IBC valuations. They will not give you any stock statement. You will just go and find what is available there and start counting backwards. So it is floor to racks, that kind of valuation, it happens there. So that is a little bit challenge because you don't have data to verify what you're doing valuing is right or wrong. So that way you need to always take double care when doing inventory valuation. So we did a valuation of in 2019, one of the gold companies in Delhi, their stock records, and I can share the reports, their stock record was showing 1.5 crore rupees diamonds, the inventory in the books. When we got a valuation done from a customs valuer, he gave us 7.5 lakh rupees. Imagine 1.5 crore rupees is in the books saying it is a diamond. When we got valuation done from a customs, he said 7.5 lakh rupees because these are all broken diamonds. And the bank got crazy. Bank said, we gave loan on considering these diamonds as a collateral. And now 1.5 crores, we are getting only 7.5 lakhs. They got it valued from another expert of jewelry. He also gave a valuation of 8 to 9 lakhs nearby that range. So that way we need to be very careful on inventory. Luckily, we were not doing the inventory. We relied on the value reports of gold valuer. So we were not in trouble. But yes, the other valuer who did that expert was questioned twice by the COC and the bankers. So now what was happening, we were all giving negative affirmations that I'm not responsible, projection is not my responsibility, I have not looked into projections, everything is by client. Then IBB issued a statement that now you need to give a positive affirmation. The disclaimer should be, the content should be positive, that yes, I have reviewed the data given by client, I have sufficient information which the client has given, so there was no shortage of time, it has been appropriately reviewed. Now see, if you read this, this puts a lot of responsibility on the valuer. And a valuer, let me just also show you this. A valuer cannot escape, because what you're writing here is that I got the information and assumption used by management. I have appropriately reviewed those assumptions. So now whatever projection client is giving, you are reviewing those assumptions. So responsibility comes on you. And you are also giving the positive statement. I have made enough inquiries regarding the basis of key assumptions. So that way you cannot say that no, the projections I have not reviewed. Now you are saying you would have made inquiries on the key assumptions. And I have done on the context of business being valued. And you have also looked onto the industry also. So you are not doing valuation in silos, that you are just looking into the company as a whole. You are just looking on the industry also. That way it will always help.
गाथा मीटिंग क्या गई हमारी आई एम नॉट एबल
सर यू आर म्यूट
सॉरी थैंक यू सो दिस वे सो एटलीस्ट सुन रहे कोई सो दिस वे व्हाट हैपेंस when you are taking ownership that I have reviewed from everywhere this puts a challenge on you so one need to be very careful when I am giving any affirmation statement that I am reviewing the projections and I need to also mention that I have adequate information and now the challenge comes I have sufficient time for carrying out valuations so this you need to be very careful you cannot get an appointment date 1st January and a report date 1st January in case of DCA valuation because you need to justify you got sufficient time to do inquiry you cannot say in one day client appointed me in the same day I looked everything and I responded in this one day I also did an analysis of industry also that way cannot happen so generally ideally there should be 2 to 3 days minimum gap between day of appointment and date of valuation specifically in case of DCA projects or complicated projects In case of NAV, you can easily take a one day, that is fine. But in case of projects like this, where you need to have at least some brainstorming, you need to have, you need to always have some timeline in your hands. Because otherwise it will be difficult to justify. You have sufficient time to carry out the valuations. Now, what are the rights of RV? They have mentioned that what RV can demand. So RV right is that you can demand all relevant information on which the projections have come. That way you can always ask the client and it would be the duty of entity to provide you these data because it is their duty to provide you accurate data. You are not supposed to do, you are not an investigator who will do a cross check of these kind of data. It is the duty of, it is a prime assumption that the management is giving a accurate information. Now, ideally RV cannot play with the projections. Even if the client is not willing to tamper down the projections, according to the my logical understanding, so according to me, the projection should be, let's say, on a lower side, but the client is aggressive. So I cannot calibrate the projections, but I can always play with discount rate. So you would have seen whenever you do any valuations and see some startup valuations, you might see a double discounting model. So in the first few years, let's say first 3 years, the discount rate would be 40% or 50%. And the third year onwards, fourth year onwards, the discount rate comes down to 25 or 30%. Because if the client is not willing to change projections and he is adamant on his projections, and he has, I'll not say adamant, maybe the wrong word. He's very confident on his projections, but you're not confident at those projections. So you can jack up the discount rate and safeguard yourselves. So this way you can always justify that client was giving projections. He was giving all, reasons also, but still I have a doubt on the success of that project. So I'll give you one latest example. Someone approached us that they are working on a technology and that technology is already worked in UK and Germany. They are working, that prototype is there. What does that technology will do? It is a so in a bank credit function. What is the, when a banker is giving a loan to a person, what is the most important task a banker must do while credit sanctioning of a person? Any quick thoughts on that? When a banker is giving a loan, any bank is giving a loan to a creditor, to the borrower, what is the first task a credit person tries to do? The key task a credit person tries to do. Any thoughts on this? Anyone would like to speak or write, whatever is fine.
Checking the CIBIL score of the borrower, prospective borrower.
Okay, so that means capability or capacity to pay, that he would like to pay or not, will he default or not? That is right. The first task anybody would like to give.
Right.
So
So we can always find by capability and capacity by the CIBIL, but we can never find the intent. Do I have an intent to pay or not? You don't know. I will give you a collateral, but if I don't have intent, that you cannot know. So when the banks would have given loan to Vijay Mallya, they would not have known his intent. They would know his capacity, his collateral, but intent was not there. So a software is under development. Their software is coming. That software, that app will sit on your mobile app. That app will read all your emails. They will read all your social media profiles. They will read your Facebook, Instagram, your all other, whatever is connected on social media. And then app will make an assessment that whether this guy is going to likelihood of default is what percentage. He may default or he may not default. So they're working on a very, very cognitive based model. Now, the promoters who are bringing this idea, they are saying, this would be a breakthrough technology. Once we got this approval and once we got this up and running, all banks in India, not only in India, all banks in Asia will take this app from us because everybody wants to save their money, bank's money. So we will charge premium for having this account. So they might be true. This may happen. But as a valuer, I may have my own own reservations that it may be successful, may not be successful. Would you think as a borrower, I would like, will I give permission to that app? Because I will have a privacy issue or various issues. Because in India, we have a different IT laws. So it may succeed, may not succeed. So he's not going to bring down his projections, but I can always bring down, jack up my discount rate. So this way I can control myself that, and standard also allows. So that's why they're saying that you need to ensure that if whatever professional judgment you are taking, you can justify that. I may disagree with the projections if it is unreal and can make necessary modifications in my discount rate. This way I can always safeguard myself. Because what is the problem in all DCA valuations and all other valuations? In NAV, I can always justify that balance sheet was there, report of land building and PM value was there. In DCF, the assessment happens after 2 or 3 years, generally. By the time the assessment happens of income tax, he has the luxury, the income tax officer has a luxury to compare the projections with the actual numbers. So if I'm doing a valuation in 2021 today, the report, I will do a next 5 years projections, 22, 23, 24, 25. In 23, when the file will get opened by income tax officer, he will also see what was the profit in 21 actual, 22 actual and 23 actual. Then he will say, okay, as compared to your projections, your actuals are not at all matching. So then your entire report is wrong. So that way it always puts a challenge on valuer. So you need to be able to justify that at the time, what was the best projections available and what you made assumption accordingly. You also need to mention some factors that when you're doing a valuation, what is the size and number of assets or shares of the company? So if you're doing a specific valuation of stake sale with, and not as per 11UA, but as per strategic decisions, what valuation shares will allow? Similar example of Renuka Dhatla case, where you are doing the specific valuation of shares, not the valuation of a company. And if you are a majority holding or minority holding, that stake needs to be taken care of. These days, a lot of cases are going into NCLT for operation mismanagement, and they are asking the valuers to get a valuation done. And I'm getting cases since 2010, where people have gone to NCLT and they're still coming now. So that kind of cases you need to see when you're doing a minority or majority, you need to give a DLOM discount accordingly. And most important is when I'm doing valuation, I need to also consider what is the government policy. Because if I'm doing a valuation and government policy is against that, that will have a huge impact. So if somebody is coming as a, if somebody comes as a cryptocurrency company, and at that time there is no clarity on government policy, so somewhere you need to give a consideration to this, that if tomorrow the government bans crypto, what would be the valuation of this company? Because there are a lot of companies who are flourishing in market now, asking people to invest in cryptos. So they might ask huge valuations, but we need to also look into the policies at one point of time. Now caveat should be the warnings or cautions I'm giving to the users who are taking my reports. So this way I am trying to give the report and justify that what is the caveat, what specific point you need to look. Restriction, limitation is a restriction on scope of RVs, that I have not done this investigation or whatever data I've got. So you need to justify yourselves, because anytime some challenges come on you, you can always say that, okay, this was I have given in limitation. You cannot hold me responsible. This will always help you. And disclaimer is always to delimit the scope of rights and obligations so that nobody can put a civil liability against you. It should be only limited to that those who are appointing me can only be held responsible against me. Whatever you do, again, IBBA is reiterating that you cannot disclaim your liability of expertise. You cannot say that if I would not have done this, so you should not hold me responsible. If my job is to do fair valuation by looking to due care, you need to look into that. And for I always give a classic example. For example, if you are doing a Tata Sky or Dish TV valuation and the client is giving you aggressive projections, so you need to look into the projections and say that now because of Amazon, Netflix and OTT platforms coming, the company may not grow with the same projection which they would have been grown in the past. So I need to take due care of the industry and environment. I just cannot blindly say client has given me data based on his past history. So somewhere I need to be a little bit logical and defend the report. Management will always be responsible for the correctness and veracity. You are not supposed to be an investigator that you will, nobody is expecting you to ensure. But that way you need to at least have some evidences of corroboration that you have actually looked into the data. You cannot make the projections, but you can always tamper, that we discussed. Now, what are the specific CLD they have specifically mentioned? And I've just given a bullet point here. If you want to get the exact text, what should be written? The IBBA has given this in a detailed manner. And nowadays, most of the reports just copy these text in the pretext of whenever IBBA reviews a report, they will at least comply with these guidelines. The most important is you need to give a restriction on user evaluation report, that this report will be used by this particular person and this particular objective. So in case of IBC, it has to be always, it should be used only by RP and COC. It cannot be used by the buyer. A buyer who is prospective giving a resolution plan, he cannot get the access of this report. So this should be only for use of COC and RP. What is the responsibility of RV that you need to mention, that this is your responsibility to issue report based on this data? Accuracy, you can always write that whatever is coming in my report, I try to be as accurate as possible. But if the client has given a wrong data, you cannot hold me responsible for client's false data. You need to always justify and report that your valuation report of DCF does not guarantee that the company will be able to achieve forecast results, because that is very important. Imagine before COVID, whatever projections people would have given, after that COVID, it all became senseless. Nobody is willing. No, so you cannot hold responsible a valuer that 2019, you have given this number. Now it is not getting achievable. So it is not responsible. And if any post-valuation date events occur significantly, that needs to be mentioned. You need to mention if these are so important that it impacts your valuation. So that can be given. Else, you can always write that I am not considering post-valuation events. That way it will help you. Because if you are giving that I have considered, then you need to justify what you are considering. It is always better to say that I have not considered post-valuation date events. That will be a valid and logical assumption. I can always give a range of value. But in case of FEMA certificates, I cannot give a range. In FEMA mandatory, I need to give one number. But in case of normal valuations, if you want, you can always give a range. Generally, people give a sensitivity analysis that if I use one method,
value is X, second method Y. So I'm giving a range between 35 to 38. So that way you can happen. So that is always possible. And you can also give a disclaimer that there is no guarantee that whatever valuation I have given, the transaction will conclude at that point. Nowhere it is expected from you that the transaction will conclude at that point where you have given a valuation report. Your valuation report just give a benchmark number to the buyer and seller to negotiate. It does not guarantee that the transaction will close at this point always. It may go at a higher price or lower price, depending on who is the best negotiator. You need to always give a caveat that you are relying on the client's representation and management, whatever it has given. And no procedure performed to corroborate information from reliable external sources. So they have said, and they have given an interesting caveat for that and limitations that you can write in a report that I have not done any procedure to corroborate information taken from a reliable external sources. So for example, I have taken any data from NSC or any data from Professor Ashwath Damodaran website or any data from MCA for any matter. And suppose later on it was found that data is wrong. So I cannot be held responsible because these are reliable external sources. Everybody relies on Professor Damodaran data. Everybody relies on MCA. Everybody relies on Sensex. So it may happen at one point of time, I am downloading a report from BSC and the rate in BSC was inadvertently mentioned wrongly for some reasons. And I relied on that wrong report. So you cannot hold me responsible. Nobody can ask me that why have you not corroborated external evidences? Because these are from reliable sources. You can always also need to give a disclaimer that you assume that the company is compliant with relevant laws. Because if you cannot find anything in contingent liabilities or any audit disclaimers, it will be assumed that company is following with all relevant laws. Because if company is not following relevant laws, there might be a penalty clauses that will impact your valuations. So in case of, let's say, for example, of a manufacturing company, if they have a pollution issue, then it can be a huge responsibility. The company can be shut down by a pollution department. So you assume that a company is complying. And if there are any factors affecting the report that needs to be given in detail, IBB has given one disclaimer, which is very good. You need to say that this report I'm giving to you, in case I'm asked to become a testimony, give any testimony or attend in court and tribunals to give my opinion for valuation report, that will be a separate engagement. You need to take prior permission from me because my report is to you. So in case client puts you in a trouble and say, okay, you need the value and need to defend the report, you can bill value accordingly, client accordingly. And that way they have given that. In case you're not getting any information as on valuation date, you need to give that kind of disclaimer very upfront and clearly. Specifically in case of IBC, you have to use this because generally you will never get the data as on valuation date. Because in our IBC, our valuation date is insolvency commencement date. And most of the times RP do not have balance sheet on that date. RP will always try to give you the last audited financial if available. And in some cases, you will find at least 2-3 years old balance sheet he's giving because the company is defunct from that day. Nobody was making any financials. So that will be a challenge on the valuers to get this information. So you need to always clearly write. And this you can also write in 11 UA. Because in 11 UA, what is expected that when you are selling the shares, the balance sheet should be as on that day. Practically, it is impossible to have balance sheet on that day. Imagine you are holding, let's say, Paytm shares. Now the Paytm is listed. Assume Paytm was not listed few months back. So if you are holding Paytm shares and you are selling those shares, then if I want to get a valuation report, how do I get that valuation report? because the law says mandatory balance sheet should be on the valuation date. Do you think Mr. Vijay Sharma would be sitting idle for me to make balance sheets for Paytm as in when somebody sells a share? He will not look for minorities. So to sell, to get the balance sheet as on that date will become a difficult process. So you need to write that though the law asks for balance sheet is on that date, client, we requested the client, but client could only provide us the March audited numbers. So we are relying on the March numbers. So that way you are telling that, yes, you know what is the law needed, but since it was not possible, so you're relying on the other method. Somewhere you need to close the valuation. Those who are land and building valuers, they've given specific caveats for them that what you should write, that have you verified the title deed of property? If yes, put in detail. Are you supposed to go to the registrar office and verify the title deed of the property? Any land valuers would like to comment on this? Is it is expected that you should, once you're doing any valuation of land and building, either in normal companies engagement or IBC engagement, are you supposed to go to the registrar office and check the original registry there? Or you will rely on the client? Any thoughts by anyone who is land or plant machinery valuers? So IBBA has...
I'm land valuer. Actually, we don't go to the registrar office and check the title deed. Hello.
So IBBI do not expect you to go also. So they have said it is not your job to go at the registrar office and verify whether the title deed is original, is not fraud. You just see the title deed from the client, what he's giving you, and you rely that he is giving you a right papers. That is a basic assumption we'll take. So it is not expected from a valuer should go to the base registrar department and get the actual numbers. That is not expected. You need to put sketch plans and photographs wherever you are getting. You look into that. Based on that, you need to take the photographs always with location, longitude, latitude, to prove that on the date of valuation you was there. Because if you have not been there, how can you do a valuation of the property? So you need to have that pictures to support. And in case you are having a land, building or machineries or mines where there is a decontamination process, that factor needs to be considered. So if I have a, let's say if I have a chemical company where the waste which is coming is very dangerous waste, and to clean that area, I need to incur X number of cost. So I need to always mention that this cost in my valuation report to consider. Otherwise it will be a huge liability later on. So that part needs to be considered. If an RV has done a valuation of a building and that building falls after 6 months, RV cannot be held responsible. You cannot say the RV has come and seen the building and they have given a valuation. So why the building fall in next 6 months? RV valuation does not give you a guarantee that the building will run for next 10 or 20 years. He is giving a number valuation based on that day. He is not checking the material inside. His job is not to test the quality of the building. He'll try to do his basic common sense check, but you cannot expect that his answer, his valuation is a guarantee that building will run for next 20, 30 years. Few disclaimers which IBBA has said you should not mention, that you cannot say business plan forecast received from client, so I'm directly relying on it and I'm not doing it. I'm not looking into independent verification. You cannot say physical verification is not possible, so I'm not doing physical verification. I'm relying on photos. You cannot say that the data is always market related, so I'm not doing any work on that. Or I did not did historical analysis because client has not provided. So if client does not provide you data, you need to do historical analysis either from MCA website or wherever possible. You just cannot say client has asked me to do only net assets method, so I will not look into other approaches. In case of Companies Act, mandatory, you need to look into all approaches. Then you need to decide which approach fits you best. That way you can always work on. You also cannot say, since I've appointed another expert, so I will rely only on his number without having independent verification. When I am appointing any expert, it becomes the duty of a valuer to look into the credentials of expert. That expert is relevant to check, because you need to see what is his background, what is his area, does he has expertise in that or not. So if, let's say, someone become a land building valuer, but there is a iron ore mines need to be valued, but he has no expertise on that. He has never had any background. So we cannot say trial and error. Ki kabhi na kabhi to shuruaat karni hai. Let's start with this assignment. Because then they will say, you are appointing an expert, but he has no expertise on that particular topic. So if I am an SFA valuer, it does not mean I would be expert in all SFA valuations. So maybe there would be some valuations, like, let's say, ESOP valuations, which I would not have done it. So it does not mean if I got a license, I can drive on all vehicles. So just like when you got a driving license, for driving a truck is a different, a trailer is a different, and a normal car is a different. So you need to see whether you have expertise in that or not. Blindly, you cannot write, I relied on another expert and close that. So IBB has given a very detailed guidelines on these kind of wordings, which you can always go upon. In the meantime, since this is caveat limitations, we have almost finished. It is almost 1.5 hours. Meanwhile, any points would you like to address on this? Anybody like to share his thoughts and feedbacks? So on...
I have a question, sir. Can
be a little bit loud. I'm not able to hear you. A little bit loud if you can. Yeah.
Sir.
Hello. Yeah. Audible.
Sir, from where we can have a sample valuation report? Is there any site or something from where we can have a sample valuation report?
Which kind of valuation reports you're looking for?
Like ESOP valuation.
Okay. So I will say, send you a... So in BSC, you can get... So at times on from BSC, as Umaji has mentioned, at times in MCA, you will get for big companies, you will get... At times, you can Google for certain valuations. Let's say for merger, demerger, you will get many listed company valuations. All valuations easily available on Google for mergers, demergers. For ESOP, I can share one website where you can get some data banks. That is a my valuation data bank. Or maybe I can send you that link shortly. There is a website where a lot of data, my valuation reports, I think. It is my valuation reports. So a lot of it is a repository where anybody can download free reports accessible on various platforms. So you can go and download those reports. Easily available.
Okay.
And most of the all listed companies you will find on the BSC website, almost all.
Okay. Right. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Umaji, would you like to share some experiences, like what you are doing in Australia and what you find difference in this practice in India, or any learning points you would like to share for the benefit of all before we move on? New things.
Hello, good afternoon, Mr. Sumit. Am I audible?
Audible, sir. Audible, sir.
Yeah. Very good afternoon to everyone. Myself is UN Pandey. I cleared my CA exam way back in the 90s. I am holding my COP since 18 January 90. So after doing 15 years of practice here, I moved to Australia. Initially, I started from Melbourne, then I shifted to Sydney. Then I was basically doing my own practice over there. So basically, initially, it was very difficult to practice in Australia because you have to start from scratch. Moreover, when I had to this office of CP Australia, they said, we don't recognize Indian chartered accountants. So I had to pass all the papers of COP Australia. Then I had to obtain licenses and everything. Then after that, I started my practice. Basically, I was doing this tax consultancy, especially international tax advisory, and tax returns of my clients. Because in Australia, if you're doing, say, financial services, you need a license. If you're doing audit, you need a license. If you're doing tax, you need a license, because all services are basically restricted services. Not every services can be done by everyone. So due to my family, say, regions or circumstances, I moved back to India in 2015. Then I started again doing this all advanced courses, everything, DISA, certificate in money laundering, then did my IP examination, then my valuation. This is the whole story. Hello.
Yes, sir. So now you did CA 1980. But imagine from then onwards working in Australia and coming back, and now in 2015 starting all these courses.
Yeah.
So it shows that learning never stops. You know, you need
to. Of course. Every day we are learning new things.
Yes, sir. So, and how? What was your experience in IBC valuations? What the challenges you face, or what
challenges
you think?
Are basically availability of data. Especially my IPs were very cooperative. They were very cooperative. So basically, I did one real estate valuation, and I did one say electronics. It's a very big organization like Moser Weir. I did the valuation of that one. And one real estate industries. After that, I realized that basically getting data is very difficult. Every time you have to struggle, either you have to approach to the IP or to this concerned companies, whosoever is there. And then you have to rely on the data, external sources, then you do the valuations. And sometimes it is very difficult to get the back to fees.
Absolutely, sir. This is the biggest challenge in IP, IBC valuation.
Yeah.
Data availability is the biggest challenge. You cannot get it.
Yeah.
And the problem is, if I write in a report, data not available, so my value will go very down. And then COC does not like it.
Non-availability of data is the least possibility. You have to try every possible efforts to get the data. Even if you're not able to succeed, you have to rely on the data submitted to the MCA, past 5 years data, 10 years data down the line, and do the analysis based on that one.
And you will get funny reasons from the promoter. So
yeah.
Promoter will say, my accountant has run away with the tally password. So
yeah.
we cannot give you access because we have not paid fees to accountant. So he's not sharing the data. No, you cannot argue with the CD promoter like this. So that was the challenge we always face in getting data, always.
In my case, we have been told all the data has been taken by the CBI and ED, and all the computer systems, everything is lying over there. So what ultimately I had to do, I had to rely on the data submitted to the MCA for the last 5 years or 10 years. I downloaded every data, I scrutinized all the balance sheets submitted last year's major agreements they have entered into. And based on that, I did the valuation.
And with this, you just one point I recalled when you said about data lying with CD, ED and customs and the
so
normally you will find in IBC some cases
yeah.
the stock would be lying at either custom bonded warehouse, either the government would have confiscated that stock or ED would have captured the stock. So what was the valuer were doing? Valuer were giving the value in the report saying that the stock lying at custom is X amount. This should be fair valued. Now, very soon, the NCLT has given an order in last week itself in one of the cases. NCLT has said that the stock lying at the ED or at the custom warehouses is not a stock of entity. So you should not assume it to be part of that entity in your fair valuation. So that will be a judgment which all valuers should take care of it. It was just in the probably last week.
Let us take another scenario. Say it's a big multinational manufacturing company. They appointed, say, around 10 CFA agents. They've got entered into agreement. They are the CFA agent as well as marketing agent also. And if the company is not able to pay them, what they do, they adjust all the stocks lying with them. They say, these are my marketing commission, which is outstanding to us. And we are adjusting all the stocks, so you don't have any right to claim the inventory back.
Exactly. This is exactly what happened in one of our valuations we did. The client had taken services from all towers. He was making telephone connections to towers. So whatever the inventory was left at these office premises, they say because he has not paid us commission, we adjusted in the inventory.
Yes, yes.
That way you need to always check it. That will be fine.
This I was telling in reference to the order passed by the NCLT, because stock lying with the government agency does not belong to the company. But even in the case of other agency like private agencies, CNF agents, stocks are lying with them and they are not releasing the stock. They are saying, this is my commissions are due. We are not releasing the stocks.
Absolutely. And this also holds good when when you are doing a valuation of a SFA and you will find an item called loans given to employees. Yes, so that will never, they will never come back because the employee will say, my salary has not been paid. So I'm adjusting against that and I'll not pay back to you. We have seen in big companies also in IBC, which went. So that was not even coming back. Similarly with advances given to suppliers. So we have what was happening. So normally if I give 10 lakh rupees to a supplier and now I say, I don't want it, pay me back. He will say, I have already incurred work for it. I've put the material for it. Now I'll not give you anything back. So ideally it will always have a zero fair value and zero liquidation value ideally. Until there's somebody good enough to return. That's a rare proposition.
We can write all these limitations in our report so that we can save our skin in future if something goes wrong.
Yes, absolutely. Because and the good part which IBBA has did was this guidelines they've given very detailed. And specifically in IBC, because we don't get data, so they have written clearly that since the valuation date is X date, however, the RP is not giving me data on the X date, he is giving me data of 1 year later, so we are relying on this data. So they have well crafted this. So those who don't have this guidelines, I can share it or it is available on IBA website also. Else, I can ask the coordinator.
We include all possible limitations and disclaimers in our report.
Yes, that way it will always help everyone. That way. So thank you, Uma sir, for your.
It's my pleasure, sir. It's my pleasure. But it's very difficult to practice in India. Very hard.
It is difficult to practice in India.
Yeah. If you go overseas, if you struggle, say 2 or 3 years over there, but you establish yourself.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely.
Like my other partner who is based in Australia, he started way back in 2007 when I started. And he is having a roaring practice. He is earning around $2 lakhs per year.
Okay. So that is a challenge, you know. There is a huge challenge here.
Due to my family circumstances, I had to come back over. Otherwise, I'm not interested.
Yeah, no, I understand, sir. Because I was also there 10 years in Middle East, so I can understand how the practice happens globally. Yes. And here we have a different level of challenge.
At least you don't have to struggle for your fees with your clients.
That is one fundamental thing here. Yeah. Here, even the COC does not pay your fees on time. They are bankers.
Yeah.
See, if an individual does not pay, I can understand. But if bankers are not paying fees, they are delaying the fees unnecessary.
Even IP is not paying the fees. Like, see, I did the valuation, IP has only released 50%. There's the 50% is foregone.
It is foregone now.
Yeah, of course.
That is what to do. Okay. Any other participant would like to have any queries on caveats or any challenges they would like to share for the benefit of all other participants which they would have faced? Anybody would like to have some thoughts? Because I'm sure everybody would have done some work and everybody would have faced different battle. So if you would like to show something, tell something, it would be interest of all. If not, then I'll move ahead. I'm not getting your Chandanji because you are getting Galaxy A30. So yeah, Chandanji, tell me.
Sir, I got a work from Delhi.
Okay.
And since I was not provided adequate data, and I thought that it was manipulated, so I left the work.
At times, some professionals try to manipulate. At times, and when there is a crook borrower and COC is also in collision, then they don't give data
because they were not giving data. And the data I got when I went to the site, I thought it is manipulated, so I left the work. But I cannot do it.
Our conscience will always take a right call because as you rightly said, and at times we get calls that we will get you one valuation assignment in IBC, but you don't need to go anywhere because the buyer is a known of CD. So CD wants a company to be bought by a respective person at a predetermined price. So they want to do not give any information. And that's the point which me and Umaji were discussing earlier. What happens, see, if, and understand, Chandanji, if I was given an assignment and I'm not getting any data, So let's say out of 10 things, they have given me only two things, two data I've got. So what I will do in report, I will give two validations, whatever two data I got. For the remaining eight, I will write not ascertainable, not ascertainable, not ascertainable, and will write in bold that I have not been provided of these data. But what will happen? My value, the fair value will be concluded only for the two items. So they will say, the IP will present to the CUC, the fair value is this only X amount.
IP I was given the data, sir. I was given all the data, but it was perfectly manipulated. I am saying this.
No, agree. I understand. So because what they will try to do, based on your value, the IP, the CUC decides what should be my, the value which should we sell the business to the resolution applicant. So if you are giving a low value, obviously the sale price will come low. And I'm sure you all would be aware of the recent controversy of Videocon. So Videocon liquidation value was 2,960 crore something. The bid came of 2,980 crores. So the NCLT raised a question that how come the someone who is bidding very near to the liquidation value? It could not be a fluke. Either somebody would have, and this is what NCLT is saying, either somebody would have leaked the numbers, either from the promoters or the COC. So this is an injustice to the rest of the IBC proceedings. So they put a stay on that. They need to reinvestigate. So some people try to manipulate. So we need to be very careful that we don't fall into that prey. Because whenever things go wrong, they first catch hold the valuers. And especially, I'm sure you will be aware, some land valuers were questioned by CBI in IBC cases in earlier, where the land valuation was dipped a lot. And and because what happens, you know, normally when you are doing a valuation in IBC, you always go with a negative view that already the company is bad, it will not get a fair value. But that may not be the always the right case, because I cannot always go with a negative approach that will have an impact on my fair value. So that way we need to always see what we are writing and what I'm doing value is right or wrong. Because ultimately end of the day, only I will be responsible for my report, nobody else. Even if somebody says that we have managed everything, nothing will happen. When something goes wrong, it first question always goes to the valuer that what have you looked into it? And I'm sure those who are doing valuation for banks, would know. And I always say being a valuer is like a goalkeeper. You save nine goals, nobody will say thank you to you. You miss one goal, you are an inefficient goalkeeper. So you do nine good valuations, client bank will never say you did a good job. You goof up in one valuation for any reason, unintentionally. And I'm saying error. I'm not saying you're doing a fraud. You might have done some error. Bank will be after your life that you have done this, you have done that. Recently, anybody from, again, this is not a discussion to take officially, but I'm just saying in Surat, some valuer has been put in custody by police recently, last 2 weeks back, something. Now the entire Surat community of valuers are putting a pen down strike there that you cannot just question the valuer upfront whenever any fraud happens. So you need to just look into the reports. You cannot always say if something has gone wrong, he would have done something. Because at the end of the day, you are giving an opinion. My opinion can be wrong, but that does not mean you can just hold me accountable always. You need to always look for the people who approve the credit. You just cannot say that people who is given a valuation, he is the only guy who is responsible. That way you need to see. So if you have no other points to discuss anything on this, then we can go for soft skills. Or if you want to take a 5 minutes break, we can take a 5 minutes break if you want. If you don't want, we can continue.
Yeah, sir, please provide the 5 minute comfortable break.
Okay. So we'll take a 5 minutes break and then we'll resume in by 16:55.
Right, sir.
Shall we start now?
Yes, sir.
Now we'll discuss on soft skills. And those were who are the those participants who are doing first time this training? Because there are some participants who are doing just first time. It is their first training of CEP. If I can just know these participants.
Yes, sir.
Your good name, sir?
Avinash, sir.
Ja. Avinash, aap kis, kis field mein hai? Like you are into which?
I'm company secretary, sir.
Achha. Okay. So welcome to the official world of RV. Now you get this, after this you get a right to sign.
Yes, sir.
And who is the other one? And Avinash, aap kahan based hai?
I'm a Delhi based, sir.
A Delhi based, okay. And who is the second one? Sandeep, aapka kab hua tha? I think you would have done earlier. No issues. So now, so I was expecting someone to say something on soft skills, but nobody said on skulls. So thought somebody will say, ki, sir, it's a typo error. But thankfully, nobody objected and nobody pointed out. So it was not a typo error, it was intentionally I have put in. We need to understand once we are a valuer, I cannot afford to make mistakes. Because once the report goes to the client, you cannot say, arre sir, pehle to galti se humne aapko 50 rupees bata diya tha valuation. It should not be 50, it should have been actually 10 rupees only or 500 rupees only. Understand, once you put a word out to a client, that sir, this is a fair value, which a range of fair value, the negotiation will happen on that and you will be bound by that value. So first thumb rule of valuation is never ever tell a client upfront what could be the fair value, because you will give a ballpark figure without looking into the details. And when you do actual valuations, and this actually happened not only with young practitioners, a big practitioners also. So what will happen, a CFO will call you and say, oh, this is the data. You do a valuation and CFO will insist, acha bas zara sa dekh ke batao, what would be the fair value? Just a ballpark figure. So aap bologe, no, let me do the working. Bole, nahi, bas aise hi bata do. So he will insist you a lot. And you will say, I think 30-35 mein aa jayega. And you said 30-35. He has fixed that number 30-35. And next day he will go and tell to the board, I have spoken to the valuer. Value is coming now 30-35. And when you start actually drilling down the data and started working on the data, your value may come either 50 or may come 20. Then he will come back to you with a big face. Yaar, aapne toh 30-35 bola tha, I have committed to the board. Now meri baat kharab ho jayegi. Ab aapko toh 30-35 leke aana hai kaisi bhi karke. Now you are in a fix. Either to lose the assignment or lose the relationship and lose the work you have done for 3-5 days. Because do you think client will give me money for the hours I spent and not issued the report? Probably no. Client will say, agar aap 30-35 mein nahi kar sakte, I'll go to some other person. So first thumb rule in valuation is never ever give amount to client upfront the fair value, else you need to work according to that number only. So basic skill is always you need to have a character. Your name should come into the market that yes, you are a man of good character. Once I have given, a trust should happen. So when you buy a burger from McDonald's or a shoes from Reebok, do you try and test ki achha hoga nahi hoga? Because there is the brand gives you a hidden commitment that yes, whatever you are buying, it will be a good product. So if I am giving a valuation to you, a client should have a faith that yes, this guy will deliver the work and it should be a good valuation. It should not have any issues and you are going to support me. You're not going to goof up around. And how you conduct with the client, the most important is conduct. The conduct is very important. If you don't conduct professionally, if you go to a client and say, and client asks you, tell me what is your fees of valuation, and you will say, sir, aapki jo achha ho de dena, mera to pehla assignment hai, aapse start kar raha hu, you cannot do that, right? You need to demand a premium, because though it might be your first assignment, but you have got a power of signature, you got a registered valuer. So you cannot just
And we need to always understand, if you are making a client first, and I'm sure Vishalji will agree and other people who just started their practice first, they will realize, if I have taken a client at a low fees first, do you think in the next year I can double up the price? Certainly never. The fees increment does not happen immediately. So never quote so low that if the client comes to you, it becomes a burden on you. So be reasonable, and I understand a newcomer has to get a assignment at least to start. So you can always quote a reasonably okay price. It may not be the best fees, but quote a decent fees. But be affirmative. It should not come like that you are not in negotiation stage. That client is not doing any favor by giving you a work. Client needs a validation certificate. And I'll tell you a very interesting fact, which a lot of people will realize. The startups always send emails to last pages of the IBBI list. When I say last page of IBBI list, when you go into the IBBI, there is a list of registered valuers. The startup people always send emails to last 2-3 pages. Why? Because they know these are new registered valuers. They can come at an economical fees. Whereas all big companies, and I can show you various emails also, whereas all big companies send emails to first 2-3 pages, because they would be the first valuers in 2018-19. So that means they would be having more experience. So it is better to have an experienced valuer. So this way you need to see where you are following your conduct and where how you deal with the client. I need to always take my accountability. When I am issuing a report, everything is mine. I cannot say my article has done a wrong error, so I'm not responsible. Anything is coming from my office, ultimate responsibility goes to me. Client may have done goof up in projections, and most of the times he will do goof up in projections. He may not know even how to compute the change in working capital properly, because most of the errors happen in DCFAs, the wrong sign of change in working capital. So if you put a wrong sign, you'll get a wrong value. You need to be very careful. What are you writing? Client may give you garbage, but the buck stops at your place. So when I am doing a valuation, I am fully accountable for what I am submitting. I just cannot say, "Aapse bhi to galti ho gayi thi." Client se galti ho sakti hai, aapse galti hone ka, there is no chance. You need to be error free. Independence should always be there in person and in presence. IBBA is very categorical on independence, so you need to ensure. You should not be their auditor. At least stat auditor, you should not be there. Tax auditor, you should not be there. GST auditor, you should not be there. And you should not have done their company secretarial compliance audit. If you are a normal consultant to them where you are charging a less fees, it is acceptable. But if you are charging heavy fees from that consultancy, which is a significant fees in your firm's revenue, your revenue, then it is a challenge. So you need to be very careful that what are you doing? And I'll share you some examples where the challenges happen. Confidentiality is very important. You cannot discuss client details with anyone. You cannot say that, okay, I'm doing this valuation of this company and this company has this data, they are doing this product. Never ever mention company's name in any public forum where you're doing valuations, because nobody would like to get data. And when even some client asks you, have you any experience of doing valuations of similar industry? You can always tell the names that, yes, I did similar industry, this company's valuation. But never tell the details what you did in those valuations, because then client will lose trust on you. Because if you can tell other companies' information to a prospective client, then you can also tell prospective client's information to another prospective client. So be very careful in not sharing the details. You should be very organized. How you organize your data, how you organize with your client, that is very important. You should always have a deadline. If you don't have a deadline, work never ends. It has to be flown from you. Take data from client. Never miss your deadlines. Suppose the client has said, and you agreed that, okay, I will give you the report in 3 days. And Dhirubhai Ambani used to make a very famous statement. Anyone can anyone can meet the deadlines. I look for professionals who can beat the deadlines. So if you have, and there is always a market theory which says that always under promise and overperform. You tell a client that I will give you in 4 days and you deliver the report in 3 days, he will be very happy. You tell a client, I will give you in 3 days and deliver on 4th day, he will never like it because his expectation does not match. So you need to be very, very categorical in matching the expectation, how you are dealing with client, the way you are committing. And in our profession, the trust is of what you commit. If I have committed 10 days, no matter what may come, I need to deliver my report in 10 days. If the delay is from client side, you can always justify. But the problem with client is, he will send you data at Friday evening or Saturday night, and Monday morning he expects the results because for him, he has given a data on Friday or Saturday. So you need to be very careful what you are committing. And if MNCs specifically love those professionals who can upfront say, this cannot happen in 3 days, it will take minimum 7 days. You tell them, they would be happily accepting. But the moment you accept, no, I will do in 3 days under pressure, then you need to deliver. You need to be very careful what you commit. You need to have entrepreneurial spirit. Now, what is entrepreneurial spirit is, I need to, so there is a cash quantity situation. Should I learn something first and wait for client, or should I get a client and then learn that thing? So if I wait for a client to come and then I'll start learning, I will be always at the end of the queue. I should always learn new things on my valuations, which is coming, because if something comes up, then I should be ready. Say, for example, now we are all talking of ESG compliances, ESG valuations, environment, social governance valuations. As of now, nobody has done in India, but people are reading from US, UK material, because tomorrow if SEBI makes compulsory, the top 1,000 companies need to get some valuation on considering ESG, it should have an impact. Why ITC is not getting huge value, even though ITC might be a best stock in certain parameters, just because they are a cigarette manufacturing company, the Canadian and European funds are not investing money because they do not fit into ESG compliance bracket. So I need to learn new things before it comes. Say, for example, if we are doing evaluations, so a lot of people must be doing normal fresh issue of shares valuation. Somebody would be expert in doing CCPS valuation, CCD valuations, Black-Scholes models, or ESOP. Say, for example, if I would be sitting or based in Hyderabad or Bangalore, or I have good connects with Hyderabad and Bangalore professionals, ESOP valuation could be the easiest cakewalk you can get, because wherever the startups are there, you will get a ESOP valuations. So this way you can start building your practice, and ESOP looks very complicated, but once you start doing it, you'd be able to understand these valuations easily. These are just models. Once you need to understand the model, we have enough material available on internet free of cost. Somebody just need to take a deep dive into the ocean of knowledge and learn from that. Communication is very important key. How you communicate with the clients make all the difference. Even if the client is making error, there is a way, subtle way to put on the client. You cannot just do a blame game. Galti teri thi, you have not done the right thing, you delayed, or tera data hi galat hai. There might be, client may be always at wrong, but there's a certain way to put. And if you cannot be a good communicator, you cannot be a good negotiator. So you need to speak very politely and very calculatively. So you need to be always be diplomatically correct while speaking with client. One needs to have professional skepticism. As one of our participants would have said that he was getting some assignment and he went there at the premise and he could not found it. He found it is fudged. So I'm sure every professional has this sixth sense. He can go and find out whether the data they are giving me, the information they are giving me is right or wrong. If I want to close my eyes, that is a separate story. But every professional who is an experienced professional will always find out whether the client is fooling me around or something else. So your professional skepticism is very important in whatever you do. And at least in our valuation, it is very important. You should always have intellectual curiosity. You should always need to read new things. There are new terms will always come in, which you need to read mandatory. If you don't read those terms, it will be difficult for you, because when somebody asks, do you know this? And you say, no, I don't know this, then it becomes a challenge. Something in valuations, if anything is asking, any new terms are coming, then you need to at least know. So for example, someone asks, there's a new concept is coming. Non-redeemable, non-interest bearing bonds. So there will be a bond where neither you will get interest nor you will get principal. So when someone asked me this, I said, then who would be the fool who put into this? Anybody have heard this kind of concept where there will be someone is issuing a bond, he will not pay interest, he will not pay principal. Anybody heard of this kind of concept?
Zero coupon, sir?
No, no. In zero coupon, you will at least expect to get a principal.
Yeah.
But here, he is not even giving you principal back. So I said, why somebody will do that and who will issue these kind of bonds? Then I came to know that in this recent world change climate meeting happened in this ESG concept, this environment, social, corporate governance issue, they realized that now the companies and the governments need to get money to take care of ESGs. So what the governments will do, government will issue bonds, and a lot of people, let's say corporates, will take these bonds like a charity, where the money will be deployed by government for taking care of environment, social and other practices, but it will not be returned back ever. So if this kind of things come and somebody will ask us to value, somebody has to value. So these new things will be coming, let's say deemed equity. Nobody has thought of deemed equity, or there is a concept of, if you go to Tata balance sheets. So in Tata balance sheets, if you have some shares, preference shares, and you assume that you will not pay, it will be considered as equity, entirely equity, deemed equity. So then this kind of valuation, this kind of approaches, you need to be aware. Things keeps coming from new. Like nowadays, people are working on SPAC valuations, special purpose acquisition companies. This concept has not come yet in India, but still there are a lot of talks going on this, and this concept might come in India. So in US, there is a concept that if I want, it is known as SPAC, special purpose acquisition company. So what happens in US? What will happen in US? Suppose I want, what I will do is I'll go to the stock exchange and list a private limited company with a, let's say, 5 lakh rupees capital with no other background. Then I will tell people that give me 5 lakh rupees each. For what? I cannot tell you for what. You just give me. So those who go on my face value will give me 5 lakh rupees. I will make a pool of 50 lakh rupees. So now I got a floated a company, got 50 lakh rupees, but why I took 50 lakh rupees, nobody knows, only I know. Now what I will do with this 50 lakh rupees, then I will go to various industries and I will say, okay, I will take 10% shares of this company. I will buy this acquisition, this company. And then I will go to my shareholders, those who have contributed 50 lakhs. Let's see, with all your money, I can do this business. I can generate this much return. If you approve me buying, I will do this buy, this company buy. If you don't like this company, I will buy another company. So this kind of valuations are happening where company started with zero, but you are giving huge valuations. In India, they are having a lot of talks on getting SPAC recently, like special purpose vehicle, where you make and get it listed. And after the SEBI allowed the loss-making companies to list, like Zomato and Paytm, the huge probability is there that this SPAC concept will also come in India very soon. Yes, Pandeji, this is like a CSR, spending by corporate, but they will be coming like a bond kind of concept. So government is working on that. It is already there in Germany and US, but they're bringing this in India. Now, those who are values need to mandatory follow the code of conduct, and at least these objectives you need to follow as per Annexure 1. You need to ensure integrity, objectivity, independence mandatory. You should have a professional competence. Once you get a certificate, you have a competence, but you need to continue keeping that. 16 hours is mandatory. You need to do a CPRs, and in a block of 3 years, it should be total 48 hours. So it may happen first year you do 10 hours, next year you need to fill up the gaps. You need to always represent correct facts. Information management is very important, how you keep data. Every 6 months reporting has to be done within 15 days. So those who are new valuers need to mention, make a table in the Excel sheet that immediately the year end happens, you give all details. What is your occupation, conditions, restrictions? If you are employee of a company and exit that company, ideally for next 3 years, you should not take valuations out of it. What is your remuneration and cost? That should be clearly. Though as of now, you're not supposed to disclose remuneration to IBBA as of now, but it may happen very soon. They may ask to pay some tax on it, just like in IP assignments, they ask. Gift and hospitality, you should not take much gifts and hospitality, which is extraordinary. Normal is acceptable. When you are RVs, what you should take care, you need to take care of minimum when you're doing some assignment, always ask email information on email. Now, those who are just new, starting new practice, need to have a checklist ready that whenever a client approaches me, that, okay, I need to get a valuation. What is the minimum thing you need to require? You cannot spend 3-4 days in sending this email to client. So client will say that you have no idea. You are taking time to get information from public. So try to keep these things ready. That, okay, I need to have minimum your last 2 years audited projections, financials, few year projections, management profile, background of directors, in case of startups, something you should need to ask. And mention in a report that whatever information we are getting is by company. In case you are getting a client who says, I cannot make projections, you make it. And for any reason, you are also making it. You should never ever send on email to that client. It should look like that client has sent you a projections. In India, it is not allowed to make projections, but in global practice, a valuer can also make projections because it is expected if the management is not able to, he can make own projections. But in India, they will not allow. We need to take care of it. Time limitations, you need to always ensure. Your expertise should come from your report. It is too much, Pandaji, it is too much. They're asking so many hours, and problem is, what is the problem? So earlier some people had misused the law. When I will not say misuse, it would be like tax planning and tax avoidance. So what they were doing, since I am IT and RV both, so I will attend one event where they say CPRs for IT and RV professionals. So I would claim from both sides and they were giving me both. Later on, IBBA realized one person is taking benefit and two places. So they stopped. They say now either you take benefit as a IP CPRs or as a RV CPRs. To me, it is actually too much. And why it is too much? You cannot expect. See, I always believe in, you can always bring horse near to the water, but you can't force him to drink. So agar IBBA bula mujhe 48 ghante karna hai, main sabko camera on karke bitha dunga. Jab mujhe seekhna hi nahi hai, what is the point of me if not learning? You put a condition. This should come from valuer itself. If I need to remain in the market, I need to stay updated. Agar mujhe hi market mein rehna hi nahi hai, practice hi nahi karni achhi, to main kyu 48 ghante karunga? Aur agar if I don't update myself, because this market works for professionals only. If I am not updated, client mujhse do sawal puchega, abhi ESOP mein aapko kya aata hai? Main bolunga, soch ke bataunga. That means I don't know. So I need to constantly upgrade myself. So it should not be regulator telling me that you should update 16 hours. I don't mind getting training of 16 hours, but the problem is there has to be enough content. 16 hours should be sufficient for IP, CA. Allow me what I'm doing in CA as an offset. Otherwise, how can you expect a member? So, अभी तो जैसे आपके पास तीन qualifications हैं, like CA, IP, 50, 60, 70, 80 घंटे तो हमारा पढ़ने में निकल जाएगा, फिर काम कब करेंगे? So that is over too much. They should not have done that, but now they are adamant. Hope the new, I don't know, that will also not help you, because in the new draft bills also they have put the same 48 hours. So that way it will not help us. Yeah, Chandan ji. Police sir.
Darwin's theory of the fittest. We have to be fittest.
Absolutely. मैं वही बोलूँ survival of the fittest. The regulator should not tell कि तुम 14 घंटे ठग रहे हो. मैं आपको वही बोलूँ ना. कैमरा ऑन करके बैठ जाओ. कैमरा ऑन करके मैं सीखूंगा नहीं, सुनू नहीं, मैं दूसरी बातें करूँ. तो आपने तो कंप्लेंट कर लिया, बट इज इट एक्चुअली बेनिफिटिंग एनीबॉडी? नोबॉडी. अब जैसे आपका लाइन एंड बिल्डिंग है, प्लांट एंड मशीनरी कोई से भी है, यू नो दैट अगर आप अपडेटेड नहीं होंगे, आपको प्लिंथ रेट नहीं पता अभी क्या चल रहा है या मार्केट में कैसे वैल्यूएशंस हो रहे हैं, आपको नहीं पता, यू विल बी आउट ऑफ द मार्केट. आपको पता होना चाहिए. सो एनी वैल्यूअर विल वर्क ऑन हिज नॉलेज. मुझे तो बिकॉज दैट्स माय ब्रेड एंड बटर विल कम फ्रॉम दिस नॉलेज. सो अगर आप मुझे नहीं भी बोलते हैं 16 घंटे करना है, तो मैं उससे ज्यादा ही करता. एंड आई एम श्योर लॉट ऑफ पीपल वुड बी वॉचिंग यूट्यूब वीडियोज ऑफ वेरियस अदर प्रोफेशनल्स टू लर्न ऑन वेरियस टॉपिक्स जिसमें इंटरेस्ट है. सो दैट वे वन नीड टू टेक केयर ऑफ शुड इट बी बाई सीपी और नॉट. But at least what a new fellow should do, you should give significant inputs to RV, whatever needed by management, these credibility and all, I'll skip, you can go through. What should not be done at least, you should not deny duty of care. What is expected from you, you cannot say that, aap dekh lo, mere hisab se to ye sahi hai, galat, aap jano. When I am issuing a report, I am responsible to each and every place. Be very careful when you are issuing a report to a client whose auditors are big firms. And I'm not telling only big fours, big 10 firms. Because whenever the big firms are auditors, they will always question your report. They will not do a fault finding in your report, but they will take you on a call and say, okay, Mr. Sumit, explain me why you have taken this percentage, why not? Then you should be willing to defend. And one simple lesson, never ever share your Excel to the client. Never ever. Always keep working with you. क्योंकि अगर गलती है तो आपके पास ही रहनी चाहिए गलती. The client should not see the Excel and find an error. And this is a standard practice. You talk to any merchant banker, he will never share his Excel to you. Never ever. So I asked. So there is an error we found in one of the merchant banking report. So we told to the client, you get an Excel sheet and I can tell you where is the exact error. So client asked the merchant maker, and merchant maker response was, no, we have some confidential formulas and proprietary information which is developed by our valuation team only, which we cannot share to others. And what is the fundamental mistake they had done was, and this is a mistake which a lot of people also do, instead of taking change in working capital by comparing previous year and current year, they have just taken change in working capital of each year separately. So they just plotted, it is a linking error happened and the entire evaluation went wrong. So ideally you should not share your working files to other clients anywhere, and never rely blindly on any information given by management. And I'll give you example of blindly relying on information. And you should always use a professional judgment. You need to make inquiries, and the best way to prove that you make inquiries is by email. अभी चिट्ठी लिखने का जमाना तो है नहीं कि हमने क्लाइंट को चिट्ठी लिखी थी. यू नीड टू राइट अ ईमेल मैंडेटरी. दिस विल बी ऑलवेज एविडेंस दैट यस यू आस्क द इंक्वायरी क्वेश्चंस, यू डिड योर बेस्ट ड्यू डिलिजेंस. नाउ व्हाट आर द फाइंडिंग्स व्हिच आईबीबीआई हैव डन रिसेंटली. सो आईबीबीआई हैज सेड दैट द स्कोप ऑफ वर्क वॉज वेरी वेग एंड द रिक्वेस्टेड डिटेल्स वर फाउंड मिसिंग. पीपल डिड नॉट मेंशन व्हाट इज द स्कोप ऑफ वर्क. Insufficient explanation of supporting evidence. So if I'm writing some evidence that I'm relying on this number, I'm taking risk-free rate as 6%. So I'm not mentioning that this 6% is from 10 years government bond as per RBI website. Somewhere I need to give an explanation of that supporting evidence. What methodology I am arriving that I am not giving explanation specifically. So I need to give a detailed explanation why I am arriving at this methodology. The worst part is there cannot be errors in numerical calculation, because Excel will not do a mistake. The mistake will be only done by the person inputting the data. So if there is a mistake in calculations, you need to be double sure on this. And there are a lot of inconsistency observed. So it actually happened in one of the report which I also saw as one of the peer reviewers. So somewhere you are writing in the report, in the initial business profile, that the client is facing a lot of crunches, the sale is going down, and the industry is going weakening. That all you're writing. But when you are doing a DCF, you're writing that
Now the sale projection will go very high. We expect a huge increase. So it is contradictory. If the business is going down because of industry, the industry cannot grow in the next year. You need to justify. If you have a justification, it has to be articulated clearly. Assumptions were not clearly articulated. Whatever you are assuming, you need to mention. So let's say if you are taking a 5% growth rate, you need to make assumption that why I'm taking assumption, or you are taking CapEx assumption, that how the CapEx will be added. If you are taking that assumption, that should be clearly articulated. How did you verify the land ownership? So you can say, okay, I looked into the title deeds given by client, that has to be mentioned. So if you're not mentioning land ownership, how would somebody come to know what you relied on? Otherwise, he will assume, a reader will assume that you would have gone to the registrar office and verified. So you need to mention. You have mentioned what is the purpose of evaluation, but you have not mentioned who is the appointing authority. So I need to always mention who is the appointing authority. In case of companies and IBC, we discussed it has to be a audit committee or board of directors. And in case of IBC, it has to be RP. A management can be appointing authority for those valuations where there is no valuation needed for law purpose. So if a management wants to do a valuation just for themselves, you can have that. Reference to important dates or missing, you need to mention mandatory appointment date, valuation date, and valued report date. It has to be always there. You cannot afford not to write caveats, limitation, disclaimers in the valuation report. Mandatory, it has to be there. And since IBBI has already given it now, so you cannot afford to say, no, I will not write it. So somebody who wants to say, no, I want to take, let's say somebody wants to become braveheart and say, I don't want to give any disclaimers. I'm willing to take all responsibilities. Whatever happens, I will go into the court. That way should not happen because you are governed by IBBI and they are asking is mandatory to put it. Now, see how the typo errors happen and how the Excel may make a mistake. Now, this was a valuation report by a big merchant banking firm. What happened in this, what was the goof up in this report was, they just put a wrong symbol here. So if you see 651, if you add cash 3, and if you deduct debt 21, it should not have become 680. It should have reduced to a lesser number. Just because in your Excel, you would have put a formula in post money that A plus B plus minus C. And in that minus cell, there was already a minus number. So the number got added and the valuation report was issued. Neither the client checked because client relied on the auditor, on the valuer, and the valuer relied on the Excel working. Ki Excel ne karaya toh theek hi hoga. But Excel is again goods in, goods out and garbage in, garbage out. You put a wrong data, a wrong valuation will come. And when the wrong valuation comes, later on it was caught by income tax department and the client need to pay heavy fees unofficially to settle it. We need to be very careful that you should not lose these kind of errors. It reflects badly on you. And that is the reason always have a double check. If you are having a team member or a partner, mandatory get it reviewed from your colleague to avoid any such errors. Now coming back to other issues. What are the factors you have taken into the valuation you have not fully mentioned? Conclusion was not provided. So if you're not providing conclusion, your report is not full. Restriction on use of reports was not mentioned at all. Notes to the reports are identical across all asset categories. You cannot have same copy-paste notes for land and building, SFA, PM reports. Figures were computed on provisional balance sheets. If I am computing figures on provisional balance sheets, then I need to mention that audited financials were not given, client has given on provisional balance sheets. I am right using the base on provisional balance sheets. It should be always management certified balance sheets ideally, because in a provisional balance sheet, if something gets changes later on, it will be have a huge impact on you. And the most important is now you need to confirm that you have looked into all the three approaches. And then you need to write why you disregarded the other two approaches. If you're using only one approach, then you need to justify why you prefer this particular approach is better. A reason has to be given mandatory. Earlier, it was not mandatory, but after the valuation rules came in 2017, it is mandatory to explain all the reports, approaches,
and tell us why you need to do this particular approach, why you prefer it is better. No standardization disclosure observed, that whatever you are disclosing, it is not in line. This is the second review happened. IBBA published two reports. The previous was the first one we discussed. This is the second report they published. When they reviewed all RBOs selected valuation reports, and they found this conclusion that this is not what we like it. And you need to mention past history of the company mandatory. So it is always better to have a company. And if it is an MNC listed company, that has to be disclosed. Where a lot of people make a mistake in this, I'm sure most of you will say, if I'm doing a listed company valuation, I would be knowing it is a listed company valuation. Why I should not write it? The problem comes in IBC companies. So there are so many IBC companies who have been listed in 2013-14 and now defunct now. But still on the exchange, they are having a license. Their name is on the exchange, though it is not traded, but they are a listed company. Though it is last 3 years, no trade has happened. It is zero on money control. But still, I need to mention that it is a listed company. The shares are not traded. And if you are doing a wholly owned subsidiary valuations, you need to give the layers of shareholding. Who are the main beneficial owners? That is mandatory as per valuation rules to identify the ownership structure. And that is the reason they are very categorical. You should not have MCC. No, you cannot see the ownership from MCA. You need to write entire ownerships. And if you are using any experts, you need to give a para. Specifically, we use in case of when we are doing a fresh issue of share valuation and company has land in it. As a SFA valuer cannot use or cannot do a valuation of land on his own. Client will always say, "Arre land valuer kya karega? Mera to plain land hai. Aap DLC rate le lo, circle rate lakhe deta hu aapko main aapko and do a valuation." Client will always try to safeguard his cost. IBBA strictly written letter to all RBOs to update their members that they cannot do valuation of other asset class on which they are not registered. So you cannot do a fair valuation of land and other assets for which you are not entitled. So SFA valuer should not do that. Client will, and if suppose you are doing a valuation and there is a land and client is not giving you, allowing you to appoint another valuer, give a disclaimer that the fair value of land has been taken based on the circle rate given by client. It has no, client has not appointed independent fair valuer. By this way, your disclaimer will at least highlight him. That way, client might be able to appoint another valuer. Since we are doing a CRP valuations, you need to consider liquidation value on going basis. I cannot just say that whenever anything is under CRP, everything will close down. You're not having a distress sale. So you need to see which parameter you are using. You cannot say validity of report is for 3 years. A lot of people were putting validity of report is 3 years. They have just wrongly used because the 3 years is the validity. 3 years is for you to make maintain records. So IBBA say that why somebody is writing 3 years validity. So they say because aapne rules mein likha hai report is for 3 years. They say that is for documentation. So you cannot write. And there is no expiry date of your valuation report. So if I have given a valuation report today, that report stands hold good as it is till the time it is contradicted. The moment, a lot of times client will ask a question, you have given me a DCA valuation today. This report will be valid for how long? How long I can use it? Any idea? If somebody would have got this kind of questions from client, then what would be your responses? That you have issued me a DCF report, so how long this report will be valid? How long period I can use it? Any thoughts? Any practical challenge somebody would have got this kind of questions? Would like to share their views? The report has expiry period or client can use multiple times or any thoughts on this?
Yeah, there should be some validity period of the report because the market ever changing in changing mode.
If I'm doing a valuation, let's say I've given a DCA valuation or any valuation, and the client has issued shares based on that report. Now, will that report be good for the client immediately after the share issue? Probably no. Because once the client has issued the shares, now my entire cash flow will change. The denominator, the number of shares will change. So client ideally should take new valuations. Either the client issue all shares at one price, one go, it's fine. But client cannot take my report, issue shares today. 3 months later, he will say, nothing has changed in the business. I am relying on the old report. Because now the value of shares have changed. Because there is a denominator would have changed and the new number of shares have changed on that day. So you need to be very careful, because normally client will always say, aap likhe de do, report is valid for 1 year. You cannot write in the report ever what is the validity. For you, it should be as of the date of valuation, period. No discussions on that. Because client will always try to safeguard his cost, because he is trying to raise the capital, and meanwhile, he tries to find people who can help him. You should never disclaim your responsibility. We discussed this again and again. IBA is categorically saying that you should not say that I am not having my liability, I will rely everything on company. You need to take the ownership. You specifically need to mention the restriction of the use of report, who will be the ultimate report. And a lot of people missed mentioning intended purpose, that what is the purpose and who can use it. And if you are having any conflict of interest, any disclosure you should mention. So for example, if I was a auditor last 4 years back, 4 years back, I was an auditor of a company. Now that company wants me to do valuation. Can I do that valuation? Certainly, I can do the valuation. Law does not stop me, and law allows me to do the valuation. But what is the valuation rule is expecting me? If you are doing a valuation of that company, just mention in the report that in last 5 years, you are associated with this company in whatever manner so are. So specifically in the disclaimer disclosure, it should come, I had a conflict of interest, or I was associated with this company in last 4 years as a auditor or director, and now I am doing the valuation, so that anybody who wants to rely on it may rely, anybody who want to discount may discount, but you need to give upfront. You just cannot put this in a very small font or, you know, in a paragraph where people cannot meet. It should be specifically disclosed. Now, I'm not sure you'll be able to read this or not, I want to specifically discuss the point I was asking on, do we read memorandums and MOA or not? So I attended one lecture probably in June or July. I attended one lecture, and the faculty was talking on how you write a report. So he made a very interesting remark. He said, your valuation report, you should write what you do and do what you write. So that sounds very simple statement, but it actually had an impact on me. So when the valuer said, write in the report what you do. So whatever you do in the valuation process, just write in the report and do what you write. So, and whatever you have written, you need to do that. So my team had give me a report that week that said, this is the valuation report we prepared. And the first thing I saw in the valuation report we write is, we have reviewed memorandum and articles of associations. So I asked my team, who has reviewed the articles and memorandum of association? And I'll be very honest, even I was also not reviewing before that. So every team said, sir, humne to kabhi review nahi kara. So I asked, why you have not done? Ab unme se kisi ki himmat nahi thi mujhe bolne ki, sir, aap hi nahi karte, to hum kyun review kare? No, they were kind enough not to say like this to me. So they said, sir, it was a practice. We have never reviewed. Now we will take care of it. So I said, because we are writing, so I want to review this. So I said, okay, get a MOA and AOA of the client. We got the MOA and AOA of the client. And it was funny. The client came to us for a valuation saying that I am into a food business. I want to make a startup of a pedigree, dog foods I want to make. So we want you to do a valuation. He given me all projections, everything of that food business. I know what is a dog pedigree comes and all, everything he explained. So there are certain, he gave me a comparables of Pawsies, Pupcart, Heads Up, Pet Sutra, everything he gave me a comparison. So we assume that the company would be in food business. The moment we open his MOA, we could not find anywhere that company is in food business. In MOA, it was saying the company, if you see my first line, I asked him, as per the MOA, the company main object clause is to render IT consultancy services. Nowhere in the main business clause it is mentioned that the company is dealing in food business of pets. Kindly justify the same as why we are not considering any income from IT consultancy in cash flows and considering trading income only of other business sector, that is of trading of foods. So when we send this email to client, and we thought that client will come with a logical explanation, you know, that the company is changing its strategy or whatever it may be, or company is a startup, or it is a e-commerce platform, something like that, it will say. And the, and then we ask various other questions that, you know, what is your rationale? If you can see this, I don't know if I can see the annotation. So we ask certain questions just to safeguard ourselves that someone, if a review happens, that what is your rationale for sales assumption of 3.2 crores in 9 months, considering you are just doing a trading and considering we have similar companies. So he was not a manufacturer. His business model was just to buy from manufacturers and sell on Amazon and other online portals. So I said, what is your USP where you can make money, like, which is more? So if you are creating a trading company, you cannot expect a huge premium out of it. And see then what we got a response. See, the client sent a response. That is a query which I raised as per the MOA, nowhere it is mentioned. So client raised, Sumit, your below mentioned query was correct, as the main object clause is to render IT consultancy services. And we have discussed the same with the management. This guy itself is a CFO. We have discussed with the management, and we are in the process of incorporating another private limited. And once it gets incorporated, we will share the data with you. Now, the reason I'm showing this is, had I would not have asked my team, and had I would not have got idea to review after attending that session, I would have also signed this valuation report, and we might have done a blunder. We might have done a blunder. Because when a company, a CFO is giving you data, you will realize, ye to kaam kar hi rahe honge, because he's giving you information. But then we need to look that whatever he is giving, that day onwards, we made a mandatory policy, whether you know the company or not, memorandum and articles mandatory need to be read. Because in articles, you will get the various classes of shares, what are the rights you will come to know. And in memorandum, at least object clause. So if my object clause is X and you're not getting income from X, something fundamentally wrong. I cannot justify to IBBI then why I missed. I cannot say, koi nahi dikhta memorandum, to main bhi nahi dekhunga. That cannot be my logic. So follow a simple rule, those who are coming into practice, that do what you write and write what you do. That way your report will always be perfect. You will not miss anything. Now, there are few valuation issues which need to take care of. There always is a bias. A biasness will always be there in valuation. When we say biasness, Professor Ashwath Damodaran always says that you tell me who paid for the fees of valuer, and I can tell you how much the biasness has come in. If the buyer has given you a valuation assignment, you will give a low valuation. If the seller has given you a valuation assignment, you will give you a higher valuation subconsciously. Consciously, you will always try to give you a fair value. I know all valuers will try to give a fair value consciously. But there is something called subconscious, which you don't know that what you are doing. So biasness will always be there, and it is very difficult to remove this biasness. The only way to remove this biasness is to get a third party check, either your partner or your peer who can assist you as a professional friend. You can just get an independent view. Second, there's always so much of uncertainty in estimates. There's too much of uncertainty in economics, macroeconomics. You don't know how market is moving, which things just move up in a day, or which sector does not start moving. So you have a huge responsibility. You need to be a little bit aware of macroeconomics. Valuation process should not become like a black box model, that you just dump everything on the system and let the system work everything. You need to have the logics clear. System will only tell what the logics you define. Client will always give you so much of information that half of them would not be relevant at all. You should not look into too much of information. See what is relevant information for getting your your essential information, essential numbers. You should be more concerned with your cash flows. If that cash flow information is fine, it is irrelevant. What is the quality of the product? You may not go into too much detail of what is the quality of cement you are using. You need to go into the cash flows most importantly. Have a proper documentation of judgments, whatever you are taking. If you are doing any conclusion, specifically, I'll give a classic example. There's a case, if you give me a minute, I'll find out the case. So there's a Mumbai NCLT case where there was a patent in a pharma company. There was a patent worth 200 crore rupees. That was a patent worth 200 crore rupees. Then it company went into IBC. The valuers, the PM valuers, who are the valuers doing, they give a zero value to that patent. So both the valuers have given zero value, and the IB and the COC got very angry. COC said, we have given this loan to this company based on this patents of 200 crore rupees worth. How can you give zero value? So it went into NCLT. So NCLT asked the valuers that why you have given a zero value. And the valuer said, because the company is having a patent of pharma companies, pharma products, the company received a warning letter from US FDA department. And based on the warning letter of US FDA department, we put it zero. And the second valuer has also given this call that I have taken a conclusion based on this warning letter only. Then NCLT asked another valuer to look into it. And the another valuer gave a value of somewhere around 150 plus crore something. Now, what did the NCLT ask to these valuers? Two valuers was, we agree, and because this pharma company was exporting only, all items were exporting. Give me 10 minutes, I'll quickly tell you the name of these two cases also. So what happened in this company? The valuer said, because this company is sending exports, mainly export sales happening only, and we got a warning letter from FDA, so we put this value zero. But then the NCLT said, have you did an analysis that this company exports to which all countries? Is it only USA or it is USA plus 10 other countries? So it was 17 countries the company was exporting. Just by getting a letter from one company, can you give zero value to all these patents? Probably no. Second, FDA only given a warning letter. It does not mean this cannot be fulfilled. So if in some of the plant in Gujarat, they do not find a people wearing plastic shoes while entering to factory, these non-compliances can be easily rectified. So you cannot just give zero value for just based on a warning letter. So then that needs to be taken care of. So you need to document what you're doing. Similarly, in one of the interesting case, the land valuer was appointed in Chennai. And the land valuer gave a value 31,000 rupees. Another land valuer also given a value 31,000 rupees. Whereas IDBI Bank, who has given the loan, the valuer of IDBI Bank given a value 18 crore rupees. Sorry, it was 13 crore rupees. So IDBI got in a fix and got very angry that when we have given a loan, it was 13 crore rupees. And today the market value would have been 18 crore rupees. It is a case of 2020. So today the value would have been 18 crore rupees. How come the valuers have given a 31,000 rupees valuation only? So they both went into NCLT, and NCLT again asked them, these professionals, why you have given a 31,000 rupees value? So what did these two valuers said? Sir, we have looked into the document. The Karnataka or Tamil Nadu or government who has given the land, they have only given the right of use. They have not transferred the ownership to this company, and this company will not be able to sell this property. If tomorrow the company merges, company liquidates, the property will go back to Tamil Nadu government back. You will only get 31,000 refund, which is the deposit you paid in 1980s at the time of taking the land. So they reviewed the property, they reviewed the documents, and NCLT was okay. That is, whatever you are saying makes sense, you will have a zero value. So you need to be very well document the decisions what you are taking, because if tomorrow somebody can ask a question, you will be able to
defend. Lack of professional skepticism. You should always have professional skepticism while reviewing the data. Human errors in punching the data is always challenging, as we discussed. You need to be very careful what you are punching. Again, I am again repeating, always take care of changes in working capital. A lot of people make errors in putting working capital plus or minus sign in cash flows. That should be taken care of always. As a valuer, you need to minimum maintain, control, take care of rules, valuation rules, code of conduct, mandatory. Companies Act, Section 247, mandatory. IBC valuation rules, mandatory. Whatever the IBC valuation rules say that you need to use IVS standards, you need to physically visit the premises, mandatory. For those who are land valuers, RICS, Red Book is sufficient. And the guidelines given by IBBI should be used in all reports. This is all from my side. I leave open to floor to questions and any points. Anybody would like to add some value? For the benefit of all other participants, I'd be happy to listen. I can unmute. If you all can unmute, then you can always come. And if you want the names of two cases, I'll give me a minute. I can tell you the name of two cases. The valuer should read these cases just for their benefits in future. Let me. And these two cases, data would be available on the website. You can easily find on NCLT. It's an interesting case. And the background of this case was, when the two valuers report came, there is no provision. So they went to the judge, NCLT, and say that two valuers have given a wrong report. You appoint a third valuer. So what does the NCLT judge said? We don't have a power to appoint third valuer because they have not given a wrong report. When I say because, there is no difference between the two, the reports. I can appoint a third valuer only when there is a significant difference in the valuation report. Since there is no significant difference in valuation report, you can't ask me to appoint a third valuer. That was a challenge which they have raised. I'm just sharing the screen. Probably you can, if you want to read these cases, you can read these cases at your leisure time. It would be interesting to read these two cases, which talks about the value of patent and how the value of land was 31,000 rupees only when the IDBI, Indian Bank, was giving 18 crore rupees. And here ICICI Bank was harping on 200 crore rupees. One is Mumbai NCLT and one is Chennai NCLT. It would be good to read. Those who like to read academically, it will be good for. And value should always take care of those, because luckily there are very few cases in valuations recently. But whatever cases happen in valuation, we need to take care of that so that you do not repeat those mistakes, or you learn from these lessons. If you have noted this down, then I can remove the screen. And one advice for new practitioners, if possible, always take fees in advance. Always. At least take a token fees in advance. Take 15%, 20%, whatever percentage makes you comfortable. Minimum take fees in advance. Because what happens, once a client gives you advance fees, that means he will not do window shopping. Otherwise, what will happen? Client will come, ask fees from you, give you some work. You will start working on that work. And then he will say, no, I'm getting somebody cheaper than you. I'll not go with you. But then whatever you work you have done, that will go wasted. So you need to be very careful in taking fees. You should always take, and there is a demand, and it is your right. Because initially we made these mistakes. We have not taken fees in advance, and then later on, client do a window shopping, and you will get so many emails from so many clients that give your quotes. Always give your best quote, and always leave room for negotiation. Whatever is sensible to you, you are free to charge whatever you feel free to charge. But always ensure that your negotiation will always, there's a concept called anchoring in negotiation. Whenever you commit a number, your negotiation will always run around that number, 10-20% plus minus only. So do not quote very low, that it will be difficult for you to make best price, best fee later on. with this I am done. If you have any questions, feel free to ask, and you like to say anything else, Mahesh will come.
Yeah, I have a question.
Please.
In case of listed companies, so any ownership of shares, even if it's 100 shares in a 1,000, 10,000, 15,000 crore company, that's a conflict? And no. That is true for the entire firm?
Again, you come back. What is the question of disclosure of conflict of interest or disclosure of shareholding?
Disclosure of shareholding.
If you can if you can just mention the key shareholders which 5% plus if possible, then you
Sorry. So suppose an assignment of a listed company comes to you and you have even 100 shares of that. So that becomes a conflict for you to do the valuation?
Ideally, yes. If you really want to get a theoretical answer, ideally, yes. Because if you go to valuation rules of, if you go to valuation rules and I think it clause 13 or 14, it says, if you are having a doing a listed company valuation, you should not have any interest in that. That is into valuation rules. So that is actually practically does not make sense, because in 100 shares, I cannot move the company's number here and there. I cannot make any much money. But standard does not expect you to do the valuation. That's a hard part.
So, and if it's a valuation firm, then all valuation partners should not have.
I will not go to all valuation partners. I will only go to the person who is signing. Say, for example, if I am having RVE, and my three partners have a shares of SBI and I'm doing SBI valuation, I will not say that you sell them, because my independence should be mine. Otherwise, it will be very difficult for any firm to work, because I will always buy some listed companies. So you cannot put a condition. Had I been an auditor, it's a different story. But in valuation, if I can justify that this, I'm holding from last 10 years. And after that valuation, I'm not taking any further stake. So that means I'm not using the information, or nor I'm influencing the information of the company. So if my stake is very minuscule, I would not mind it. So I'll give you another example similar to your question, Navinji. Though the standard says you should not have a direct or indirect interest in the last 3 years. So a lot of people have strict interpretation that indirect interest means I should not have any given any services. So assume I would have given a client a just service of filing GST return, and I have charged only 1,000 rupees, let's say. Okay. Does the standard means by charging 1,000 rupees, it becomes a conflict of interest? I lose my independence? Probably no. So I will always give a service if I have given a consultancy service only. I will do a valuation. That's my personal call. But had I would have done an audit, stat audit or GST audit, tax audit, then Companies Act specifically has a challenge that you should not do, because it Section 143 have a challenge on this, that you should not do these kind of services. So I will not do a valuation if I'm an auditor. But if I'm doing small minuscule services, I will always take the chance, because then it is not an actual conflict of interest. And I will also write in the report that I have, during the year, I have provided very small advisory services, which does not impact my independence. So this way I'm giving disclosure, and that should be what the intent of law, that I'm telling people what I'm doing. Again, these are my views. I go by my views, my call I've taken. Some people say, no, if you are giving any 500 rupee service also, you should not do your next 3 years. To me, that does not make sense. That's my personal take. I always take.
So IBPI is not talked about. So for example, RVE, IBPI is not laid down any. It has to be interpretation only.
It has to be interpretation. Because we have also put an email to IBPI. You'll never get a response. I have also put emails to two RVOs that give your response. They have put it to IBBA. They have not reverted on this. And the response will come. As a professional, you take your own judgment call. So I will take my call that way. Okay, because a lot of people have faced this kind of issues. Those who are CAs and multiple big firms, and they are doing valuation. So should we do valuation? So if you are doing subsidiary valuation, subsidiary audit, can your partner do valuation of holding company? In my view, answer is yes, you can do, but there is no clear cut yes and no from the regulator. And then if you're making a disclosure, it should not have impact generally.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I have a two question. First, suppose if I'm filing annual accounts for my client for last 2-3 years, can I undertake this valuation practice?
if your total fees, let's say, and I'll give you, there is no right or wrong answer written on the rules. Suppose your total fees of the firm is, let's say, 1 lakh rupees, let's say, okay, and you're getting 20,000 from this client. So that means it becomes a material client for you. So your independence is influenced. But suppose I'm getting 5,000 rupees from this client services. So it is less than 5% or less than 10%. So I can always take a call that I'm not my independence is not impaired because of my transaction, which I'm doing. If you're just doing advisory services, I can still take the call. And if I would have been in your place, I would have done that. But if I'm doing a secretarial compliance audit or these other audits, specifically statute audits, then I would not have done the valuation.
Okay, understood, sir.
Awesome. See, because we need to, Avinash, I also need to understand, client will give work to a known valuer or a known valuer?
To known valuer.
General, a known valuer. So your filing is written for last 3 years. So he has faith on you. He has comfort on you. He would like to give work to you rather me. So which makes sense and which is purely fine with client's perspective. So if I can justify that it is not getting impaired independence, I can always do that. That should be fine.
Understood.
What is the second question?
Second question, in one case, my NAV value, the value of per share comes in negative. So can I take rupees 1 or
10? For company issue, it has to be 10 rupees or what is their par value for company shares. If you are selling for income tax purpose, it can be rupees 1. And there is a case law. There is a case law in ITAT Mumbai in 2019, where 1 rupee value is allowed by tribunal. That is fine. It is coming negative, then 1 is fine.
Okay.
There is a very interesting case where 10 transactions happened at rupees 1, mm-hmm, and 1 transaction happened at 75 rupees. Same company. Then ITAT rejected all the 10 transactions, saying 75 is the fair value because one person bought at 75. Then tribunal rejected that since the 11U is giving minus number, so 1 is fair number. And if somebody is buying 75, that's a strategic sale. So that way you are fine. But issue has to be always at the whatever is the par value coming. You cannot go below par value.
Okay.
Even in net assets.
Understood, sir. Thank you, sir.
Mac, are we good to close? If no other queries or anything left.
Yes, sir.
Thanks a lot.
So I'd just like to take this moment for the vote of thanks. Thank you, sir. It was indeed an insightful session. As I take this moment to thank our faculty for a wonderful session today, I would also like to thank our respected audience for making this session interactive and productive. As Mr. Ratan Tata ji once quoted, all of us do not have an equal talent, yet all of us have an equal opportunity to develop our talents. So let us take all the opportunities that come our way and work towards our betterment and growth. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Have a good day.